Time for Dixie State basketball here on ESPN Radio 97.7 FM. The triple cast as well. The Trailblazers and the Chadron State Eagles getting set to do battle here inside the Burns Arena. And this should be a good one. Dixie State off of the heels of the 69-38 record-setting victory last night. And tonight they welcome in a very, very athletic team in Chadron State. The Eagles, 6-8 overall, 4-4 in the RMAC, coming off a tough overtime loss to Westminster College last night, a game that, you know, everybody thought that Chadron State was out of that game a couple of different times, and they came back, you know, threes, whatever they needed to do to get back in it. And Dixie State, though, 5-7 overall, 3-5 in the RMAC. We've got Devin Dixon with us. Mike Olson will also join us. We're going to try to do a little three-man crew throughout the night as best we can. We've also got, on the TV side, Kylie Young, a Dixie State graduate, and has been doing a ton. She actually worked the last 3 years with David Locke up on the Jazz radio crew. She'll be doing sideline reporting for us on the TV side throughout the night, and then hopefully as we go throughout the season, we'll be able to get that plugged into the radio side as well. Devin, good to have you back on the broadcast. Mike will join us here in just a minute also. And Devin, your just quick hitter thoughts on this game as we jump into a quick Dad's Trucking pregame show.
Well, Chadron State's in the middle of a tough stretch. I mean, to go to Mesa and then have to go up to Westminster and then come down the freeway here to the Burns Arena. I'm sure they're well aware of how good the defensive effort was last night for Juddy and the guys. So this is a very important game for them. They're 4-4, right in the middle of the conference race right now, and still in a road win would be huge. They're very athletic. They like to get out and pressure. They like to shoot the three. That's a trend I'm seeing more and more in this RMAC conference. A lot of teams that like to shoot the three. In fact, Dixie State dead last in three-point shots made this year with 65. Juddy'd rather get the easy two than the three, so that doesn't surprise me. But there's some strengths of this Dixie State team that we'll talk about as well. But I think a fun matchup for the fans. It's been an exciting week. We had a great crowd last night with the D1 announcement and ready to put a winning streak together. Haven't got a two-game winning streak yet in the RMAC, so why not tonight, Carrick?
Slow start last night to the game, and Mike, you and I were on the call of that one. We'll bring Mike Olson into the broadcast here as well. What does Dixie State do tonight to try to avoid another slow start tonight and put on a show right from the start?
Well, it's going to take energy right away and a lot of effort. As soon as that ball goes up, guys have got to be ready. You saw last night, Juddy went to the bench very quickly because he noticed that they were low on energy. So right away, you're at home, chance to, like Devin said, to put a win streak together. You've got to come out with some energy right away. You know, Casey Winters, Coach Winters, before the game said, sometimes we like to get punched in the mouth before we react. Well, they can't wait to be punched in the mouth. They've got to be the ones off to a good start and put Chadron on the defensive right away.
Yeah, Dixie State was fortunate to have an opportunity to punch back last night because that MSU Denver squad, it was good defense by Dixie State, but the Roadrunners went a little cold as well. Dixie State was able to hang around and then take over. I don't think the Trailblazers will be able to do that a second night in a row and overcome a slow start. You've got three different guys that average double figures. Colby Jackson, team leader, 5'9" junior guard from Las Vegas, 12.9 points per game. He can shoot the three, excellent free throw shooter, don't want to put him at the free throw line, shares the ball really well as well. Deontay Champion, senior guard from Pearl, Mississippi, 12.2 points per game. He is very efficient from the field, 50% from the field, 6 rebounds per game, 3 assists per game. And then how about Michael Sparks off the bench, providing a spark, 12.7 points per game off the bench as well. Those are three guys you're going to hear their name a lot tonight. This is a Chadron State team that averages about 74 points per game. They're shooting the three-pointer about 40% as a team. They'll put up shots. If you don't be in your spots, they'll hurt you.
And that's interesting because Dixie State about 30% from downtown, but not as high volume a shooting team like I alluded to earlier. But, hey, that team that came in last night was averaging 70 points a game, and we held them to 38. And this RMAC schedule, we're learning a little about it this first year in the conference, but these Friday, Saturday back-to-backs are not easy for these guys, for their bodies. You tweak a little something. Can you find the energy that Olson was talking about, play through some injuries? We've had to have some guys do that. It was good to see Jack back in the lineup last night. Didn't get his normal minutes, but got some minutes. Didn't force it too much, I don't think. I'd like to see a spark out of Quincy Matthews tonight. Yeah. Quincy, I think, needs to start with the working hard on the defensive end. I think the offense will come if he lets it more within the framework of the offense. I think really his focal point needs to be defense to get more minutes and to get the trust back from Dixie. He's got off to a really slow start for his senior season. Not what I was expecting. I don't know about you, Mike.
No, I think you're right on. We talked at the beginning of the year how deep this team was. Well, that depth needs to show itself today. And guys like Quincy, that, you know, they're due for a breakout game. They're ready. And there's no question that Coach Judkins and his staff needs Quincy to be big tonight.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Let's take a look at our Mountain America keys to the game as we're getting closer and closer to tip-off here. I talked to Coach Juddy. These are from Coach Judkins. The thing he emphasized, number one, was transition defense. Transition defense tonight going to be so important. They get about 75% of their buckets in transition, so that's going to be the number one thing. And then he wants to go inside. He wants to pound the paint, so we'll look at the points in the paint throughout the game. And then handling their pressure. They like to get up and really hawk the ball and put a lot of pressure on the guard line and the wing line. So handling that defensive pressure from Chadron is going to be another key for the Trailblazers to go try to get a winning streak tonight, get two in a row. They had won two in a row before Thanksgiving, but they haven't won two in a row in conference play. See if tonight's the night.
They will try to do just that tonight. Dixie State, Chadron State on top, on tap, excuse me, inside the Burns Arena. National anthem coming up here in just a minute inside the arena. 20 minutes up on the clock for the first half. Let's step away. We are going to take a 2-minute timeout for the national anthem. We come back, we've got some Lonnie Boys Barbecue starting lineups for you here inside the Burns Arena.
Guess what? We've been invited to move up to Division I and join the Western Athletic Conference. We are really excited about this opportunity, but we needed to make sure it was the right decision for our athletes, students, institution, and community. So DSU hired Collegiate Consulting to conduct a feasibility study, and we looked into all of the pros and cons ourselves, and
we have some exciting news to share today.
We are accepting the invitation to the WAC.
So what does this mean for DSU?
It means that in July 2020, Dixie State University will be home to a Division I athletic program,
which opens many opportunities for our students, university, and community.
For starters, Division I schools often experience increases in scholarships, enrollment, and completion rates.
Other benefits like more rigorous academic standards, more attention on a national stage,
NCAA and WAC revenues, and increased booster support will be amazing for Dixie State.
Currently, the WAC doesn't include football, so you may be wondering if we'll have a football team. The answer is absolutely. Football would be an independent Division I team, like several other institutions.
Benefits for the community include increased tourism and revenues,
along with big name programs coming into town for the community to come see us play.
But by far, one of the best parts is playing more Utah schools and creating intense rivalries with other WAC schools,
such as UVU, Cal Baptist, and Grand Canyon University, in addition to having the opportunity to play nearby D1 competitors, such as SUU, Weber State, and Northern Arizona.
Hi, I'm Jason Booth, Dixie State University's Director of Athletics. This is an exciting opportunity for DSU and a natural step in the development of a growing institution and community as we evolve from university status to university stature. We hope you're as excited as we are, and we invite you to come to our games and show your support for our Trailblazers as we prepare to become a powerful Division I athletic program in the WAC and across the nation.
6:23 and 4 a.m. last night. We'll see if Dixie State can maybe play that to their advantage. Overtime game last night, long drive down to St. George this morning, although Coach Judkin said last time that happened, in a team that they came and they thumped us the next night with the Pueblo game. They'll look to avoid something like that happening tonight. Before we get this thing underway, we've got to give you some Lonnie Boys Barbecue starting lineups, and it goes like this for the Chadron State Eagles, the visitors tonight. 5'9" junior guard from Las Vegas, Nevada, Colby Jackson. A 6-foot redshirt senior guard from Denver, Colorado, Jayshon Jackson. A 5'7", 175-pound senior guard from Pearl, Mississippi, Deontay Champion. A 6'5", 215-pound senior forward from Chicago, Illinois, Jeremy Ruffin, and a 6'8", the big man down low, 255-pound senior center from Denver, Colorado, Charles Gavin. The Eagles, led by head coach Houston Reed, his third season at the helm here at Chadron State, 12 wins, 56 losses, and they try to get Coach Reed win number 13 tonight. How about for your Dixie State Trailblazers with Jack Pagankoff still bringing being brought along slowly after the injury. He does not start tonight after playing 10 minutes last night. And the Trailblazers will start the same way they did last night. They'll start Zach Frampton, Andre Wilson, Matt Conway, Dub Price, and Quincy Matthews. Quincy back into the starting lineup for the second night in a row here inside the Burns Arena. Those are your five as Coach Juddy goes for win number 540 overall as a head coach, 534, excuse me, but this would be win 250 here in Dixie State if they can get it done tonight.
Yeah, and let's hope this starts a nice long winning streak. The wins have been tough to come by, 3-5 in conference play. Now you've kind of taken yourself out with those five losses of winning the RMAC realistically. Now you're just trying to fight your way back into the top half of the conference standings. But you got to take it one game at a time. And I like that move by Juddy to put Quincy back in the starting lineup. Try to infuse some confidence into him. You know you've got some depth, even though you still have some guys out due to injury, guys we haven't seen in a long time, like Austin Montgomery. But I like what Conway's doing. The story behind that, Juddy and Conway's father, Matt's father, they played together. And, man, 16.9 points a game. He's really got it going. He's shooting a great percentage from the field, around 50%. His three-point shooting is fantastic. I know Juddy got on him a little bit last night about one on a trailing three, but
he made it.
He made it. He did make it. He did knock it down, which kind of softens that a little bit.
I was talking to Quincy, or excuse me, to Matt after the game about just that, actually. And he said, man, I wish I could get the green light a little bit more on that. And he's like, I'm leading the team in three-point percentage. But he knows this. That's a great part about a good player like Matt Conway. You know, he'll take the shots when he feels like he can get them. But he's going to do what the coaches tell him, and he's a team-first type of a guy. And 19-13 last night. Yeah. See what he can do tonight. Again, tonight they'll need another big game for Matt Conway to get the win tonight.
Yeah, 11-20 from downtown, 55%, 53% from the field. You know, get Bubba Wilson going a little bit. I think Juddy was talking in the postgame a little bit about being ready to shoot. So it'll be interesting to see if Bubba can really get a rhythm early, Mike.
That's right. And rhythm is key, you know. And you, as a shooter, you're trying to get a guy involved. You've got to pick your time. You've got to pick your place. And I think a lot of what he's doing with Quincy Matthews is that same thing. I think he probably sees a matchup that they have an advantage with Quincy Matthews. So you're right on, Devin. That's key.
Let's play some basketball. Dixie State and the home whites. Chadron State in the road maroon uniforms. It will be Gavin for Chadron State, Conway for the Trailblazers. Chadron State going to win the tap, nearly tapped it out of bounds, but the Eagles able to track it back down. It'll be Jayshon Jackson setting up the offense left wing, guarded by Mac Frampton. Off a screen, holding, looking inside of the big man, Gavin, nothing there. They'll reverse it to the left side, Champion. Skip past top of the key, Colby Jackson. Over to Ruffin, looking directly inside of Gavin, the big man, swinging it back to Ruffin. Back outside, Colby Jackson, 9 to shoot. We are scoreless so far. Jackson, dissing it inside. Jeremy Ruffin reversed from right to left. He'll score.
Good possession. Great ball movement. Dixie State defended well till the very end, and then a nice little lay-in there. But you like the patience if you're Chadron on the road. That's a good start.
19-18 to go in the first. 2-0, Chadron State lead. Dub Price, Dixie State's first possession of the night. Frampton falls to the floor with it, skidded on his knees. Lucky to not be called for a travel. Here's Conway, 18-foot jumper right side, too strong. Rebound to Colby Jackson and Chadron.
It was probably a little bit too early for that jump shot right there. The play was just about ready to develop, but Matt Conway trying to find a shot early.
Eagles the other way. Here's Champion. Now to Colby Jackson, right wing three, rattles it in. A 5-0 lead for Chadron State, and here we go again.
And they move it quick, which got Jackson an open look.
Quincy Matthews inside. He'll score for his first attempt. Off the window from the right side. He's got two. Dixie State within three at 5-2.
Important bucket for Q to get his confidence going early on. He only had 3 points yesterday.
There's Colby Jackson. Got two Jacksons on the floor right now for Chadron State. We'll try to distinguish between the two as best we can. It's Champion, left wing, dribble handoff to Jayshon Jackson. Jayshon inside looking for Gavin, the big man, and he'll score easily over Conway. 7-2, Chadron State lead, 18:08 to go.
Boy, Gavin, 6'8", 250. You got to put a body on him because he's a low down low.
Andre Wilson driving inside, absorbs contact, runner off the window, hits the deck, no whistle, and a jump ball going to be called. Ball was tied up after the rebound. Quincy got in there. Dixie State going to get it back on the arrow.
Yeah, I like crashing the glass there. Couldn't get the rebound, but still just like putting his hand in the cookie jar, just trying to get a quick tie-up, and the whistle came quick enough for Shatter, and you don't like that quick tie-up, but alternate possession, Blazers have it back.
Lob inside of Frampton. Frampton back out to Quincy. Trailblazer logo right wing, 24 to shoot. Quincy probing, stripped out of his hands, regains, forces a shot, left side, no. Too strong, Chadron the rebound. Ruffin across the timeline. Hesitates, drives to the baseline, left side, back out to Gavin. They'll reset and set up the play with Colby Jackson, D logo straight away. Jackson wearing that double zero on the jersey over to Jayshon Jackson, and the strip taken away, Dub Price with possession, bounces to Quincy. Quincy catches, scores off the window, no, wipe it off, offensive foul.
Well, you gotta love the attack, you know, on the break right there. Dub Price did exactly what he needed to do. Quincy took off, great spot, maybe a jump shot, a little bit better, but you love his aggressiveness. You gotta keep attacking.
You gotta give Jackson a little credit there for sliding over. He was there early. I can't disagree with that call, guys. That was a good charge taken.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. 17:05 to play, Dixie State trailing by 5-7-2. Colby Jackson giving a jab step, rolls off a screen, hands off to Jayshon Jackson. Shot clock down to 5. It's Jackson, left wing to Colby Jackson. Driving inside, floater with the right hand, no. And an offensive foul the other way. Same call. And Zach Frampton going to draw the charge. He also had Andre Wilson hit the deck. Dixie State gets one back.
Yeah, got to be consistent right there. Just outside the restricted circle. He didn't bump him until almost he was coming down on the floor, but still the contact was there. And I like that. If you're going to call it one way or the other end, you got to call it the other way. And just barely outside. That restricted area is tough as a player to know exactly where you're at, so you got to give Frampton some credit there.
Wilson has it stripped away by Colby Jackson. Sneaky steal there ahead to Jayshon Jackson. Trying to thread the needle to Gavin inside his tip. Went off two white jerseys and out of bounds. Eagles maintain possession, 24 to shoot, 16:27 to go.
Tough cross-court pass there. Jayshon Jackson trying to thread the needle, and just the reaction is to deflect it. Last touch by the Blazers.
Inbound pass go to Michael Sparks. He just checked in for Chadron State. Cross-court pass, Deontay Champion, and he traveled with him before he put the ball on the floor. Turnover.
Right away, you can see Coach Yudkins loves that matchup with Quincy. With Quincy Lewis and Champion. So Champion's their guy, and I think the assignment for Quincy Lewis tonight is to be that guy to stop it.
Turnover number 4 for Chadron State. 7-2 lead for the Eagles, 16:10 remaining, approaching the under 16 media timeout. Wilson left wing with 18 to shoot, will bounce to the left block, and Dub spinning to the baseline, shot blocked by Ruffin. And Champion comes down with it for the Eagles.
Dub throws a pump fake in there and then goes in. Maybe draws a foul. Instead, he tried to elevate over Ruffin, and the timeliness of that block was perfect.
Colby Jackson holding left wing to Sparks. Sparks dribbles around a screen. Back to Champion, right corner. Top of the key, they reset. Colby Jackson, 10 to shoot. Calls out the play, drives inside, fakes a pass to the right, dishes to the left side. Sparks for 3, too strong, and is tapped around by Champion, and the Eagles will reset. Your under 16 media timeout, next whistle. Champion guarded by Wilson. Pick coming. A lob inside Gavin. Passing it to Champion. One dribble, hangs and hits. Double teamed, and he scores in traffic. 9-2, Dixie State trailing by 7.
And they're having to exert a lot of energy on the defensive end right now, and the shots aren't falling. Need a quality possession here for the Trailblazers.
Frampton. Kicking it out to Wilson. Julian Decree. Wade Miller up off the bench to check in. Next whistle. Quincy Matthews, 17-foot jumper right side, rims out. And it will be rough in the rebound. Here come the Eagles. Well, this is almost a rerun of last night, isn't it, Mike?
Yeah, it is. Slow shooting start for the Trailblazers.
Gavin holding baseline left side, just lost it. May have been stripped out of his hand by Quincy and off his leg. Either way, Dixie State going to get it back. A slow start. Pagankoff, Miller, and Ducree all heading into the lineup after this timeout. 14:37 to go. Dixie State trailing 9-2. 60-second timeout back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
Man, where's Carrick? The show's about to start.
Carrick Stegmiller approaches his ball after a beautiful approach shot. This ball landed about 12, 13 feet away as he lines up the putt. He'll have this one for birdie.
Hey, have any of you guys seen Carrick?
I think he went that way.
Segmiller eyes his ball as he lines it up. Again, this putt for Buddy will win the tournament. He steps to his ball. The putt's on its way. It's got the right speed. It's in! Carrick Segmiller for Buddy to win the tournament as the crowd goes wild. Woo! He is celebrating. He is ecstatic.
Yeah! Oh, Carrick, we got shooted in like 5 minutes. Let's go.
Come on, man. I'm just playing some golf. Let's go.
.1437 to go. Dixie State trailing at 9-2. Mentioned just before the break, this is almost like a rerun of last night. Devin, Mike, what do you see when you look at the stat sheet? What's jumping off?
First thing, Dixie shooting 16% from the field, 18% last night. They forced 5 turnovers, but haven't capitalized on those. So they've got to make better use of their possessions with their scoring.
Pagankoff, Miller, and Ducree all into the lineup for Dixie State. We'll see if it makes a difference on this possession. Pagankoff immediately into Ducree, working on Gavin, the big man. He traveled. He doesn't like the call, but going to be called for a travel. And Coach Judkin saying that's a right-handed move. You're on the left side of the floor.
Yeah, I think he was thinking about what move I'm going to make and kind of maybe just drug that foot just a little bit. You know, I'd like the ball fake and then go to either the left or the right hand. Julian's got the size to elevate and get that shot off.
He definitely has the size, but Charles Gavin's a tough matchup down low. You mentioned the size before. That's going to be a big matchup. You've got two very physical post players fighting for position on the block. If Julian can catch it right where he wants it on the block and wait for the action to happen ahead of him, that's going to clear things out for him enough to make that move. He's just got to be 1 second more patient.
14-20 remaining here in half number one. Dixie State trailing 9-2. It'll be Michael Sparks, left wing for Chadron State. Bounces to Colby Jackson. 17 to shoot. Jackson trying to bounce over to Ruffin. Shot clock was at 13. Kicked out of bounds by Pagankoff.
Yeah, good to have him back. Yep. I mean, sometimes a kick doesn't hurt you.
And they're going to put it back out to 20.
Kind of reset.
Oh, now they put it to 30.
Get a quick breather.
Now it's the 20. They gained 7 seconds after the kick.
A lot of these Eagles possessions, they've been working it all the way down towards the end of the shot clock.
They love that right block. You look, you know, mental note, every possession they've had a right block post touch. They love it on the right block. And I think a lot of that is setting up the shooters. A lot of their three-pointers have been happening on the left side of the floor. So if they can get a right block touch and then reverse it quickly, that's definitely part of their offensive structure.
Some sort of moisture or something, sweat on that south baseline. They've been working on that a couple possessions in a row. Here we go, back in play. They got it mopped up. A lob into Champion. Whipping it inside to Sparks. Sparks to Colby Jackson. Jackson calls out the play with 12 on the shot clock. Crossing over to his right, leaves it with Sparks. Deep three straight away, and it's nothing but the bottom.
I like this kid's stroke. I mean, again, get it out to him. He's ready in rhythm. Triple threat. Lets it fly and splash. Down it goes.
12-2. Chadron State lead. 13:37 to go. Here's Ducree. Left block. Kicking it back out. Wade Miller. 15-footer left side. In and out. Gavin the rebound. And here comes Chadron State. Sparks left corner. To Colby Jackson. Looking inside. Gavin. He's fouled by Zach Frampton. Frampton really had no choice. He had to either let the layup go or foul him and put him on the free throw line.
That's a good foul.
Yeah.
Real good foul. And, you love it when your point guard goes down, sticks his nose in there with the big guy. So that was a good foul, prevented a bucket, put him on the free throw line. Yeah.
Charles Gavin this year, you're right, 50%, 9 of 18. So the odds are maybe split a pair here.
There's free throw from Gavin on the way, too strong. Already, the foul does pay off.
Yeah.
And the double team out high, and that's what allowed him to roll down that lane. And that was a pretty good entry pass into Gavin to get him to the line.
What do you think, Dev? You missed the first one. 50% chance?
I'd say 50-50 whether he makes this one. Knocks it in. Gavin with 3 points and a 13-2 Chadron State lead. Dayson Youngblood checked in before that free throw.
Trailblazers need a bucket here, guys.
Yeah. Coach Judkins going to his bench, trying to find his spark. Miller to the free throw line. To Youngblood, right corner, swinging it back out, Pagankoff. hit a buzzer beater going into halftime last night. Can he draw something up here? Pagan Koff, no offensive foul. Going to be called against Julian Decree away from the ball.
You know, to tighten that up, I mean, you got to stay stationary when you're setting that pick. If you move just an extra little hop step, they call it. That didn't seem like a lot for a television audience, but that's what they're cracking down on.
Freedom of movement.
12:50 to go. Jayshon Jackson. It's a screen. We'll pass it inside. Walker Andrew. Pump fake. Shot no. Tip put back by Gavin. Rims out. And then Ducree is going to tip it off of Dub Price and out of bounds. And it'll go back to Chadron State.
That's already 8 rebounds to Dixie State's 0. I mean, they are crashing the glass on the offense and defensive end. Even though they didn't secure that one, we're getting a lot of second chance opportunities here for the Eagles.
Sparks to the far side and Champion. Top of the key, Andrew. Back to Champion. Get inside Gavin. The Champion, step back. 15-footer left side, no. Good box out by Wade Miller. Pagan Koff gathers. Ahead to Youngblood, nearly stolen. And thrown back in by Deontay Champion. I like how casually Pagan Koff, you know, catches that bullet from about 2 feet away and just tosses it back to the ref and says, let's go.
Who can provide a spark for the offense?
Pagan Koff to Price. Will it be Youngblood? Straight away three, no, off the left. Gavin gathers the rebound for the Eagles. 13-2, Dixie State trailing by 11, 12:08 to go.
Got to continue to work hard on defense. Keep this within reach till you start warming up from the field.
Gavin holding on the right side. Now to Sparks. Boy, this team is athletic, aren't they? Jayshon Jackson, and we knew that coming in. You see him in person. Very well coached, good team. Sparks down to 2. Shot clock at 1. 3 is blocked by Pagan Koff. Shot clock violation. Will that be what gets them going? It's the under 12 media timeout. 11:43 to go. Dixie State trailing 13-2. We're going to keep it right here on the TV side for a sideline report from Kylie Young. Radio 60-second timeout and back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
Thanks, Eric. Yeah, Coach Jenkins, a little frustrated with the start, especially on the defensive end. He had a message for his team. He told his guys, no, if this guy is going to drive on you, make sure he comes to you. Don't be going to him. Back to you, Eric.
Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause, and a big thank you goes to Mountain Fraternity Union. 11:43 to go in the second, and just like when we came back from the other media timeout, Dixie State still with that 2 on the scoreboard. 13-2, Chadron State an 11-point lead. It's still a ton of basketball to be played. Dixie State can just settle down, find a couple of buckets, and be just like last night. They'll be right back in it.
That's right. Well, one stat, you know, that right now, Dixie State has not gone to the free throw line. When things aren't working and you're finding it hard to get into a groove or not getting your shots, you've got to attack and get to the free throw line. You've got to find a way to get to the free throw line and maybe find your stroke or manufacture some points that way, but it just shows lack of aggression when you haven't shot a free throw in 9 minutes.
Dixie State with possession, Wade Miller to Dub Price inside Ducree. Good movement without the ball, good pass, good finish. Ducree breaks the scoreless stretch. He's got 2, and it's 13-4 Chadron State.
Yeah, and if you remember back, the first points of the game was Quincy Matthews in the lane. Now more points in the paint. All 4 points coming down low, kind of to your point. Let's challenge him inside. Let's get to the free throw line.
Eagles with possession. The lob out to Deontay Champion. Adum Bang, 6'7" senior forward, into the game. He'll catch. Pump fake. Blocked by Ducree. Dub Price comes down with it. Bouncing ahead to Wade Miller. And then Wade throws it away. Stolen by Champion. One-on-one with Youngblood. Slashes in front and scores it. Costly turnover.
Tough to play transition D when you lose it on the perimeter like that. Bubba just didn't anticipate him cutting in front of that pass.
15-4, Chadron State on top. 10:38 remaining. Pagankoff to the free throw line, stripped and stolen by Jayshon Jackson. Boy, Chadron State, quick hands here, and then Jackson is slammed to the ground by Dayson Youngblood, and the scrum on the way back up the floor is bumped into each other.
I can tell you, they are showing no signs of travel fatigue. You know, this mentioned before, they are all over the place. Very fast, very athletic. Look at their backcourt. Those guards are extremely active. They're flying all over the place. Reaching, they're scrappy. Great backcourt for Chadron, but for Dixie, they've got to counteract that with just patience. Take care of the ball and start being who they are. They need to find their identity this game and just be who they've been before.
10:29 remaining. Dixie State trailing 15-4. Delamont swinging it to the far side and Mills. Top of the key, Jackson calling out the play with 14 seconds remaining. Jackson inside of Andrew. Floats, can't get it. Andre Wilson the rebound. Can Dixie State find a bucket? Wilson to Wade Miller. Top of the key, Conway.
Bubba missed Julian down the block. He had a chance to maybe whip it down to him, but couldn't find him.
Youngblood to Conway. Draws contact, free throw's coming. Matt Conway so good at getting inside, either scoring or getting to the free throw line. That foul will go against Walker Andrew, his first.
Yeah, I like the patience there. Didn't see the earlier set like I was mentioning, so work it down to Matt. And Matt finally earning the first trip of the night to the free throw line, which is a welcome sight. You know, Juddy always preaching, hey, let's get easy points. In theory, there's nothing easier than a free throw.
That's right.
First free throw from Conway.
And I'm so glad Matt made that after I just said that.
Well, he's the guy you want at the free throw line.
And they kind of gambled a little bit there. They tried to poke it away, and that allowed Matt to turn the help defense coming over, forced a foul. Great awareness from Conway. 16.9 points a season, first year as a trailblazer. And they needed every one of his points this year.
Second free throw on the way and in. 2 points for Matt Conway. He's on the board. Can that get him going? Dixie State back within 9:15-6, 9:48 to go.
That was a comeback last night. Looks like it's going to take a little bit more of the same tonight.
There's Delima. Jackson looking inside to Bang. Back to Delima. Spot up three left wing. Bang.
Good rotation out of his hand. Delima, this kid can shoot it. He was ready.
18-6. Chadron State a 12-point lead. Wilson crossing over. Kicking it back out. Conway to Youngblood. Right block. Dupree. Jump step into the lane. Shot is off the left side. Rebound Chadron State and Ruffin. Leads for Jackson. Back to Ruffin. To the right corner. Three on the way from Mills. He missed it. And it's knocked out of bounds by Quincy Matthews. Chadron State will have a fresh 30 on the shot clock. Frampton back in. Youngblood to the bench.
You know, I like how Wilson stopped Ruffin. He got stopped ball, but that left that open three. That one just didn't drop for the Eagles. And then the loose ball. Rebound. Nobody could collect.
Andy Jackson. The lob to Ruffin. Into the left corner, Colby Jackson for three, and he hits. Timeout, Dixie State. Coach Judkins has seen enough. It is 21-6. Trailblazers trailing by 15. 9:04 remaining. 30-second timeout. We keep it right here. Timeout's brought to you by Catering Concepts. But boy, oh boy, this time, unlike last night, Trailblazers did not start chipping away, and Chadron State has not slowed up one bit.
Well, they're having a hard time making the adjustment. Last night, Dixie was able to make a quick adjustment, find what was working. They're almost forcing it on offense. They're trying to do too much. There's too much of that stepping outside of the offense, trying to make a big play, and I think that's the purpose of this timeout right now. Coach Judkins is getting him back on the same page. Let's regroup. Let's just start being exactly – sticking to our game plan and not trying to force it too much.
And for Houston Reed, he's got to love the way his guys are started. I mean, Colby Jackson's 2-for-2 from downtown. He's got 6 points. Champions 2-for-3 from the field. They're spreading the shots around. This seems like a very unselfish team. And already 7 assists on 8 made field goals. That's a good number. That's a number that Coach Judkins would like to see right now.
Dixie State nearly threw it away. Wilson will pop a three straight away and knock it in. Intermountain Healthcare three-pointer knocks it in. The Trailblazers within 21-9 desperately needed that bucket.
Confident stroke two. Nobody there. You've got to hit that one.
Colby Jackson, left wing, driving inside. High off the glass, no, but a foul.
A lot of contact down low. What's the call?
How many bodies? One, two, three, four, five. Five guys on the floor. It'll be Andre Wilson picking up the foul. A hit on the arm. We'll send Kobe Jackson to the free throw line.
Julian slid over a little bit late. They don't call the block, though. They get Wilson with the reach in.
Wilson's first. Colby Jackson, not the guy you want at free throw line. 87% on the season.
And he's been there a lot. I mean,
yeah.
49 of 56, now 50 of 57. So, you know, for as small as he is, right around 5'9", he's able to use his body, hang in the air sometimes when he's attacking the rim and get the line.
You hit it right on the head, Devin. He knows how to use his body very well. He's got a good handle with the basketball. He's very good at getting into the key, absorbing contact.
Missed the second free throw, but it goes off of Dub Price and out of bounds. Dub is looking around like he didn't quite know what happened, but it looked like to me it went off of Dub last. Wade Miller in, Ducree back in, Conway out, Quincy Matthews out. They're going to keep switching up the lineups, trying different things, and try to figure out what works. Colby Jackson, baseline right side to Trigger. Holding. Lobs to Gavin. Hand off Delamont. Drives inside and he'll score in traffic.
Well, you got to respect the three. So when he gets it up high, it looked like he was a triple threat. But then, boom, goes by you. And a nice touch there to finish by Delamont.
Dub Price, left wing, Dixie State. Looking for something. Into the right corner. Pagankoff, three on the way. Left it short. Dub Price had the offensive rebound. And then he's crushed out of bounds. And oh, they're just going to call it out of bounds.
Yeah, on the replay here, we'll get a good shot for our audience on CEC TV, but maybe Dub's foot was on the line when he was touching it.
Yeah, that's the right call.
Either way, if there's no foul call, Dixie State was going to lose that possession.
Yeah, absolutely. And there was, on the replay, no contact. Two guys going for a 50-50 ball. 7:55 to go. We've got a media timeout, next whistle. Ruffin. Handing off to Colby Jackson. Jackson, three-point land straight away. Will step into a three. They left him space, left it short. Rebound, Gavin, and he lays it up and in.
You know, Dixie State lucked out there. They had the switch, and Julian Ducree was guarding the point guard at the top, and he decided to take the three-pointer.
Trailblazers quickly up the floor the other way. Pagankoff forcing the issue, dishes to Ducree, who was fouled. He'll get two free throws.
Yeah, but a little bit better attacking quickly, not waiting, not letting the defense get set. Drive, penetrate, draw the defense to you, then give it to Julian and earn a trip to the line. Did they say it was on the shot?
I did not see, but they are standing over by free throw line. I think, yeah, they're going to get free throws. 7:29 to go, Dixie State trailing 26-9. We got a 60-second timeout and back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
John McCain and other people would just sit there quietly on the sides, and that many Republican activists would refrain from registering their disapproval in the peanut gallery?
Some might argue that Republican activist is an oxymoron.
Oh, I don't think so.
Okay.
I think there's a lot of activism.
Right.
But do you see what I'm saying? If you just flip it right over on its head.
I would like to flip it on its head, and in fact, I'm already doing that because my own position is free speech is free speech. Okay, and I'm kind of advocating for something that I'm really not supporting in this respect, as far as protesting or not protesting and being able to recognize your audience. What we need on either side, I don't care where you're coming from, is the ability to recognize the audience.
.729 to play. Ducree is going to the line for a pair of free throws. And these are big ones. You'll take any point you can give. Ducree, though, 48% from the free throw line. We'd love to see him hit a couple here. First one rims out. They just gave out pizza during the timeout to the loudest section. That was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was.
You guys weren't making very much noise. I'm kind of hungry over here.
Well, those DJ and Aaronie from Big Kick and Country.
Oh, okay.
And so I was kind of keeping an eye on them. I raised my hand and tried to flag them down because I knew Mike would be hungry, but they didn't see it.
Ducree makes the second free throw. Dixie State within 16, 26-10. 7:20 remaining. Jordan Mills holding. Back to Jackson, three-point land straight away. Still holding with 10, swinging to Ruffin. Down to 8 on the shot, driving to the baseline, pushing off. He's going to get called for it, yes. Extended the arm, pushed off on Youngblood, and he's called for the offensive foul.
Quick Hurst Ace Hardware update, NFL. For our radio audience, Rams right now having their way with the Cowboys. They trailed 7-0, but they've went on a 23-0 streak to take the 23-7 lead. And it's about 8 minutes left in the third quarter of that game.
6:55 to go until halftime. 26-10, Dixie State looking to put together a little run here before the break. Youngblood to Frampton, left wing three, bang!
That much needed triple. Had one earlier from Wilson, now another one from Frampton. Those wide open threes, when you're trailing like this at home, much needed. Cut the lead in half.
Chadron into Gavin, left block working on Ducree. He'll swing it to the near side, and Champion looking inside to Ruffin, a steal. Dixie State on the run, here's Frampton. Top of the key, hands off to Wade Miller, three, bang! Back-to-back three-point shots for the Trailblazers, and they're within 10, 26-16.
Well, they're confident. You can see them now. There's a little bit more energy. They're bouncing around a little bit. They're talking. They're very active. They can feel that momentum shifting a little bit.
6:05 remaining. Champion loses, and they're going to say last touch by the Trailblazers. 6 minutes even remaining here in the first half. Dixie State within 10. 17 to shoot for Chadron State. It'll be Colby Jackson to trigger baseline right side. And Chadron State going to take a timeout.
Yeah, good timeout right there. You don't want to get three on, maybe four. You don't want to throw another turnover because you just gave up the three-pointer in transition. And right now, Juddy loved to see his team get this down to 4 or 5 at the half, maybe even go on a big run and take the lead. Chadron would love to keep this double figures on the road because they got to feel like, hey, no lead is safe on a back-to-back in RMAC play.
Sure. Well, if they're going to do that, Devin, they've got to start in the key. Right now, 12-4 points in the paint for Chadron. They're dominating that key. They're out-rebounding Dixie. They've got to do a better job of establishing some post play. They'll get back into this if they can get a little bit more balance.
Yeah, 16-3 on the glass right now. And that's not routine. That's very unusual for the Dixie State Trailblazer team. They're one of the best defensive rebounding teams and upper echelon in the RMAC in offensive rebounding. So that's a strange statistic right now. 16-3.
Jackson will lob in. Eagles with possession. Here's Champion. 14 to shoot. Back to Jackson near side. Jackson to Sparks. He'll fire a three straight away. Rims out. Julian Ducree goes up. A grown man's rebound right there. Miller bounces into Dub Price. And is he fouled? Yes, he is. Dub Price is fouled. That'll be team foul number 5 against Chadron State. And personal foul number 2 against Jeremy Ruffin. How about that rebound, Mike? You were nodding your head in approval.
That was big. That's what you need. You need big physical rebounds like that.
Youngblood will lob in to Price, quickly to Frampton. Back to Dayson Youngblood. Here's the Ducree, left elbow jumper, yes! The big man stretching it out, knocking it in. Dixie State within 8, 26-18, a 9-0 run for Dixie State over the last 2 minutes.
Well, if he can hit that shot, that's going to open things up in the paint. When he turns and faces and pops, now he can give a pump fake and go and draw a lot of attention on the defense to Mr. Juju.
Ruffin inside, offensive foul against Ruffin, his third. And that will bring Adum Bang back into the game. Also coming off the Chadron State bench is Walker Andrew. He stays, is found a spark here. Some wave of momentum, how long can they ride it? 5:15 until the break, whole new ball game. Single digit lead for Chadron State at 26-18. Price hands off to Wade Miller. Wade bouncing into Ducree, spinning, scoring on the right block.
Julian Ducree is bringing the energy.
He took
the charge, made that jumper, now a low block move. Now they get crowd into it here. This momentum is up for grabs. Dixie State seems to have seized it right now.
26-20, 11-0 run for Dixie State. Jackson will bounce to Andrew. Back to Jackson with 8 to shoot. To Andrew, 6 to shoot. Champion with 4 and 3 inside, hangs and hits. Rattles around and falls through for Deontay Champion. 28-20, Chadron State lead.
No, they were being very patient, but Dixie was looking at that shot clock, just hoping that it was going to take just a little bit quicker. Great defensive possession for Dixie.
Here's Wade Miller, top of the key to Dub Price. Price to Youngblood, loses, regains 18 to shoot, approaching the under 4 media timeout. Ducree spinning inside, puts it up, he's fouled. 2 free throws for Julian Ducree, and a foul against Adun Bang.
Well, you wonder how long before Chadron goes back with Gavin, gets Charles Gavin back in the game, because Julian Ducree has really been that spark, and it's happened on the block. Devin, you hit it. He's making plays offensively, defensively, rebounding, and he's been very active. You know, Carrick, you asked a question. Who is going to step up and be that spark for Dixie? It's been Julian Ducree.
Misses the first free throw off the left side. He'll try to shake it off and make the second one and cut this lead to a 7-point Chadron State advantage. Second one on the way. No. Chadron State rebound. Champion hands off to Colby Jackson. Under 4 to go until halftime. Media timeout coming on the next whistle. Here's Champion. Top of the key. Michael Sparks. Swing it to Jackson, left corner. 12 to shoot. Bouncing into Bang. Sparks with 7. Jackson with 5. Straight away 3. Too strong. Ball is loose. Frampton gonna dive on it. And then Bang lands on him. And Frampton loses it. And Chadron State will reset. Then Bang loses it. And it's going back to Dixie State.
Well, it's Dixie. Coach Judkins wanted the foul. You know, it's getting very physical. And Frampton doing a great job getting on the floor. But Dixie's got the possession now. Now they've got to capitalize on it.
3:23 to go. Dixie State trailing 28-20. Let's take a 60-second timeout and come right back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
There is a place where looking out means looking in. Where an impression lasting only a few seconds will be imprinted on a life forever. Where courage is forged and innocence rediscovered. Where remembering is rewarding and forgetting unforgettable. There is a place where truth is felt and where seeing is believing. There is a place.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this. I need a one dance. And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
.23 to go, Dixie State back within 8, 28-20, had it down to 6, but then back out to 8. Julian Ducree with 7 points and really has been the spark plug in this 11-2 run for Dixie State over the last 3 minutes.
Well, and the thing with Julian is it starts with his defense. You know, when he plays good defense, like he takes a charge, then let the offense come to him. I think that's a big key for him because we know he can score the basketball.
Dixie State with possession, 3:13 until halftime. Wade Miller, left wing, waiting for Dub Price. Back to Wade, quickly back inside Ducree. Working on Bang, floater left hand, no. Good look, just wouldn't stay down.
That's a tough angle to hit a hook shot.
Sparks, swinging to Champion. Champion inside, Bang catches, stolen by Zach Frampton, but he's on the baseline. And he flew out of nowhere, stripped that thing, but he was standing on the end line.
Tell you what, Deontay Champion, act like he's shooting and drops that pass in perfect. That's a next level pass, I like that. But that helps side defense, kind of sneaky. almost a takeaway for Dixie State.
The lob into Andrew. 17 to shoot. Quickly inside, bang. Will turn and score over Dub Price. Lead back to 10.
Another 2 points in the key.
Youngblood with 2:35 remaining will set up the offense. The three-pointer would be just great right now. Youngblood gives it to Wade Miller, left wing three. Couldn't quite get it to go. Almost had my wish granted. Pass ahead to Champion, full court pass. And he loses, tipped away by Julian Decree. He just shrugs his hands and said, I didn't do anything. Dixie State the other way. Inside to Decree, spinning, forcing, hitting with contact. And one for Julian Decree.
Again, defense leading to offense. He goes straight up, gets a poke away, and goes down to get rewarded with maybe the old-fashioned three-point play.
He's got nine. You see that Coach Judkins looked out at him and said, see? And he kind of looked back over at Juddy and winked and pointed. Did you catch yep. that exchange? And Coach Judkins has preached, you know, from day one, if you will buy into my system, you'll be rewarded for it. Free throw rims out.
That's the only chink in his armor right now is he can't hit a free throw. Everything else is flawless.
Deep three from Sparks. No. Dub Price the rebound. Maybe an ill-advised three for Chadron State.
Certainly one of their quicker shot attempts of the night.
Frampton has it stolen away. Chadron State's got it back. Sparks to Champion. Champion runs over Dub Price, blocking foul. And at first look, I think it's probably the right call. Dub, I think, was still sliding over to try to take that charge.
Well, he's out of position, and, you know, Devin, you touched on it at the beginning of the game. One of the keys, transition defense. It's not only important to get back, but you've got to stop the ball. And right now, Dixie's getting back. They're just not stopping the ball, and the point guard's getting way too deep into the offense, and it's causing some problems.
Deontay Champion, 60% free throw shooter at the line, and he misses. Pushed it strong. Brooks the Bison standing right below the basket.
Folks listening along, field goal as we stand, 48% from the field for Chadron, 36 from downtown. Trailblazers, after that slow start, up to 42% from the field and 3 of 6 from downtown. But free throws hurting Dixie State, only 42%, 3 of 7 right now. Chadron a little bit better, but not much, 2 for 5 as we get another one now.
Champion will make the second, took his time on that one. 9-point Chadron State lead, 31-22. 1:45 to go. If Dixie State plays it right, they can get a couple more possessions. Here in the half, can they make them count? Youngblood drives inside, layup, finger roll, no, but he's fouled. Passed up the three-point look to try to get inside at a better look. And he'll get two free throws.
Well, what's one thing that you've seen differently is we're referencing Dixie going to the free throw line a lot more the last 10 minutes and the first 10 minutes of the game. They're getting back into this game by attacking and getting into the free throw line.
Quick Hurst Ace Hardware update. Cowboys score, touchdown, go for two. They've cut the Rams lead to 23-15 with 5:20 left in the third quarter. Love me some NFL playoffs, even though my Seattle Seahawks are out.
I'm waiting for a Knights update.
The Knights update? I got you.
Youngblood missed the first free throw, makes the second, and Jack Pagankoff will check in for Youngblood.
Knights.
After the make, 31-23. Go ahead, Deb.
They're trailing to Chicago, 3-2 on the road. About to start the third period, so still a game.
1:25 remaining. Dixie State looking for a steal. Frampton got the tip, but it goes out of bounds. 18 to shoot. Chadron State will inbound about the left wing, the out of bounds area. It'll be Jacob Jefferson. First time we've called his name tonight. He'll inbound. He'll swing it to Jayshon Jackson. Jackson, shot clock down to 10 to Jefferson. Turnaround jumper on Conway, left it short. Dixie State has the rebound. Here's Pagankoff. Chance to cut the lead to 6 or even 5. Decree to Conway, working on Jefferson. Jab step spinning, forcing it, no. Hits the deck. Jefferson the rebound for Chadron. Pass ahead to Jayshon Jackson. Skip pass to Sparks. Sparks into the lane. Jump step floater. Airballed it. His leg kind of gave out at him. And he's holding something. He's down under the play. Miller the other way. Chadron State the rebound. And now they're going to stop play as Michael Sparks has gone down under the Dixie State basket. He He landed awkwardly when he went for that jump step in the lanes. Like his leg just gave out on him.
Yeah,
and he never got back up.
He's a key component for this team, too. Averages double digits, about 12 a game. Shoots it good, 40% from downtown. Yeah. Scary moment for the Eagles and their fans.
Hey, you hate to see a player get hurt, especially like that. But offensively, you know, you look at Dixie State right there. They had a 5-on-4 advantage. You know, they took a quick shot rather than trying to use that advantage. And you know, they could use the 2 points right now. You hate to see somebody get hurt, but it doesn't look good.
No, absolutely carrying him off. Looks like it's the right lower leg and ankle that went buckled. And
I have a guess. I'm not going to speculate. Don't want to. 36.8 seconds remaining. 30 seconds on the shot clock. Chadron does have possession. He'll lob it into Jayshon Jackson. Looks he's staying, get a stop. They might get one more shot. Trying to cut into this lead here. Having to keep Delamont traveled. Never had full possession, but we finally got it. His feet were just moving a million miles an hour. Gets called for the travel. And now Dixie State will have 25 seconds to set up a good look to try to maybe go in trailing just 6 or maybe even 5.
Yeah, he was curling and coming. And if you bobble that at all, you can't get a bounce down in time. That's what happens. This is a free-flowing offense, though, and you're going to have a few of those. This will be a big bucket for the Trailblazers. They have not played an efficient half. To get a bucket here, close the gap, going to the break would be big.
Pagan Koff with 6. At the Conway, 3-pointer straight away, no. Frampton the rebound, and he's fouled on the putback with 0.9 seconds remaining. I'm thinking that Conway 3 may have been deflected just a little bit. Kind of came off weird.
Well, it's a little bit deeper than he's used to shooting.
It handed his face.
A few feet back, and hey, heads up Frampton.
Yes.
Great rebound. That's tough to rebound a shot that's short. So Frampton doing a great job of tracking the ball down.
First free throw, good.
Yeah, and Frampton can't wait either. I mean, he's got his back to the clock. He knows time's ticking down, but he throws up an athletic flip shot, trying to get some English on it just to beat the buzzer. Great pitchers there from our CEC crew.
Frampton, second free throw, good. Pass ahead, Delamont, half court heave. Oh my goodness, he missed it, but that was so close. How about that? Dixie State has clawed its way back into this thing, trailing 6, 31-25, trailed by as many as 12 here in the first half. And we're going to toss it on the TV out to Kylie Young with Coach Judkins.
Coach, at about the 6-minute mark, your team went on an 11-0 run. What sparked that?
Radio, let's take a...
How do you replicate that coming back out in the second half?
We got to figure out. There's 2 games in a row now. We've had really bad starts. Just not playing defense and not getting good shots. So we get down 21-9, and then our guys, okay, it's time to play. We can't do that. We got to keep playing the whole time. And I thought that last 7-8 minutes we played pretty good. So we changed up our defense, and we're going to keep them off balance. But we got to score inside. We're missing too many easy baskets.
What's your message to this team at the half?
That's what it's going to be. We got to go inside. We got to defend. Okay, we're waiting for somebody else to do something else. We got to defend.
Okay, thanks, Coach. Good luck. Carrick?
All right, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the floor your Dixie Blaze dance team. They will be performing Bossa Nova Baby tonight, taught and choreographed by Amber Shakespeare. The dance team is coached by Corey Esplen. Let's hear it from the Dixie Blaze dance team. Thank you.
Welcome back inside the Burns Arena. I apologize for that kind of awkward toss of timeout. We're on separate for you radio listeners, just so you understand. We've got a sideline reporter for TV, but that audio is not connected into radio, so we kind of have to stagger when we do those reports, and it was kind of an awkward transition. I apologize for that. By next game, we'll have it sorted so we can have sideline reports on the radio side as well. The Dixie State trailing 31-25 as we enter the InfoWest halftime report. But when you consider that the Trailblazers trailed by as many as 17 in the first half, and the way that they've played here in the first half, the fact that they're, really a two-possession game with two threes, they're in it. It's amazing that they're even in this game considering everything that's happened.
And you know Juddy will have some adjustments to make in the second half. He's so good at the preparation. Mike, you know this as good as anybody. I don't know what his secret sauce is, but he'll have a plan and they'll come out. The fact that they got down to, but I was thinking with about the 5-6 minute mark, if they can get down to about 5 or 6 points, it's huge. Unfortunately, you combo that with the fact that Michael Sparks got injured. They were able to get Juju going a little bit on the block. Julian Decree, 9 points in the first half, and kind of started things off with the defense. I like the effort defensively. Things started to pick up a little bit, got a couple of three-pointers, but certainly when you shoot 36% in the first half, you're probably going to trail, especially at home, but you got the whole second half to look forward to.
Well, the way it started, you're almost happy to be shooting 36% at this point.
Yeah, it started out,
three for 12.
Now they've got it out to 36% and back down to 6. And
1 for 8 before 3 for 12, too.
Oh, my goodness. They're going in there. And, like you said, Coach Judkins will draw something up in the second half, no doubt. We hope that we see something like we saw last night in the second half, just total dominance. But, Dixie State, the fact that they're in this thing, is a testament to, they never quit, and this team, we can't ever rule them out of a game, and it's just best case scenario to even be in this game still, considering what is going on. We have a marriage proposal going on out here. We might out on the court. Sorry, I got a little distracted there.
I think Brooks is getting married.
Brooks the Bison. Yeah. Actually, two of our athletic interns. They work with Wendy Bulkley and Katie Bornstein. And I think
this is a real proposal?
Yeah, he's right there. Here it comes.
Oh, nice. Well, it's been a big week for Dixie State. Add another, and what a week to do it at the Burns Arena after the D1 announcement, a nice win last night.
Wow. Okay, back to the InfoWest halftime report. You start with seeing everyone walk out with roses, and they've got this music playing. What's going on out there? Is it senior day? No, not yet, but let's jump into the numbers. We mentioned the shooting percentages. We mentioned the spark a couple of different times throughout the first half. We'll bring it up again. He leads all scorers. Julian Decree with 9 points, 4 of 6 from the field. Like I said, the only knock on him right now is 1 of 5 from the free throw line. Otherwise, he'd be in double digits already. He's got a rebound. But Dixie State needed somebody. They went inside. They found Julian Decree on a night where they couldn't hit anything from outside 15, 18 feet.
Well, it was interesting because Julian went to the bench, and about 30 seconds later, Juddy reinserted him. I think Juddy was feeling like he was the one guy that was really a potential difference maker, and then he backed it up by going out there and doing what he did. And a few of the things Julian did do not show up in the box score, taking that charge. He went straight up. I don't know if he got credit for that straight up block that got deflected that led to points and a stop and pop three. But they need two or three other guys to kind of complement Julian. But you started to see the defense lead to the offense there in the later stages of the first half. And I'm sure that transition defense is going to still be something that Coach Judkins is going to be preaching to the guys in the break about. And Shadron's got to feel good about the spot they're in. They stopped going inside as much. The early part of the game, I thought the Eagles went inside a lot, and then I thought they started settling for more outside jumpers. And when they did go inside, Dixie State was able to adjust. The help side defense definitely improved about this 10-minute mark on in the second half, and that allowed Dixie State to kind of chip away and get a little bit better offensively.
That's right. It was a great adjustment by Coach Judkins defending the post. He started sending that help side over, and they were putting a lot more pressure on the ball. I think at the beginning of the game, they were giving a little bit of space. They were allowing a little bit of space, respecting that athleticism and expecting them to drive, but they were entering the ball in. So I think the adjustment Coach Judkins made was pressure the ball a little bit, make that entry pass extremely difficult, and that took away some of that post play.
Trailblazers trailing 31-25. Take a look at Chadron State at 42% from the field, but they did a lot of their damage first 10, 12 minutes of the half. 12 of 28 from the field, 4 of 12 from the outside. All those threes came pretty early as well, just 3 of 6 from the free throw line. And it's been Deontay Champion. He's got 7 points. Brady Delamont had 5 points. Kobe Jackson has 7 points. They're really spreading the scoring around, everybody getting involved. Like you said, one of their spark plugs, Michael Sparks, going down with an injury. It'll be interesting to see how they bounce back from that. Will that fatigue begin to creep in the second half? But, I mean, they played a heck of a, you know, first 10, 15 minutes of basketball. Dixie State clawed its way back in it, and now they've given themselves a chance in the second half.
Well, and we didn't get to the free throw line for what felt like at least the first half of the first half.
9 minutes. Took the first nine minutes.
You're right. And now, you know, we got to the line 11 times. I think that can be attributed a little bit of the comeback, because they start, and even though they didn't shoot it great from the free throw line, it still helped. Julian only 1 for 5. That was the one flaw in his game in the first half. But, you know, rebounding at one point, it was 16-3. And Dixie State ends up losing the board battle 23-10 at the half. That's something Juddy's going to circle and highlight and put on the whiteboard in the locker room, and definitely want more effort on that aspect.
Absolutely. I think there's an Expo marker that lost its life when he looks at the offensive rebounding statistic. You know, Coach Judkins loves offensive rebounds, and that's one of the first things he's going to look at. And only having one offensive rebound in the first half, that's not going to sit well with him and his staff, because that's – they're missing shots. Dixie's missing shots, and so they've got to crash the boards.
Dixie State in their games, 37 rebounds a game. 37 rebounds a game. I think they're number one in the RMAC in that rebounding offense category, so I think you're spot on.
Well, and I think the other thing is leading to the lack of offensive rebounds is he's probably sending his guards back just in effort to stop the transition defense. So I'm sure he's releasing two guys saying, hey, get back, don't even crash. Your shot goes up, you get back. We cannot get beat in the transition. So they're probably down two more rebounders than they're used to.
Dixie State trailing 31-25, but they are right back in it. And we got some musical chairs going on out there. Let's take another two-minute timeout. When we come back, we'll take a look around the RMAC, see how MSU Denver is doing up at Westminster. We'll take a look at a few other games as well. Two-minute timeout and back in the InfoWest Halftime Report.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West, set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
Hey, I ordered a large veggie with garlic herb crust.
Veggie? I thought you were more of a meat eater's man.
Oh, I am, but now I can do both. Look, flavor patch.
How does that work? What happens when that's gone?
I've got Howie bread strapped to my legs.
Flavor fanatics love us because we make our dough fresh daily and have meal deals for any budget.
Hungry? Howie!
Flavor fanatics welcome.
From surgical suites to patient rooms to conference rooms. In scrubs, suits, or sneakers. With stethoscopes, computer code, or mops. We are all caregivers. Intermountain Healthcare, healing for life.
Camping World is here to help you connect to adventure and explore the outdoors with friends and family. Offering new and pre-owned RVs to fit every budget and thousands of parts and accessories for any need. Camping World has it all. With over 130 super centers nationwide, you're never far from America's number one RV dealer. No matter where your adventures take you, whether you need an RV, parts, or service, Camping World is here to help you every step of the way. Visit Camping World in St. George or shop campingworld.com today.
Show up your booze for the Buffalo Dale Fans Camp, the band with the best.
Welcome back inside the InfoWest Halftime Report. 31-25, Dixie State trailing by six. Let's jump into some RMAC conference updates for you. We look around a bunch of other games going on. A couple of games already complete. Regis taking down Black Hills State 80-65. South Dakota Mines, a 73-60 win over Colorado Christian. And games in progress. New Mexico Highlands hosting Western Colorado, 92-80. That game started about a half hour before ours did. And they lead Western Colorado, New Mexico Highlands, 94-80 with under a minute to play. That's the same New Mexico Highlands team that Dixie State took down, I don't want to say with ease, but almost with ease that night. Played a great game in that one. Colorado School of Mines, a 40-37 lead over Fort Lewis, early second half in that game. Westminster 48-39 over MSU Denver in the second half. And those are your RMAC conference updates for you. Dev, what do we got professionally? Give us some more NFL playoff updates.
Yeah, game you heard earlier here on 97.7 ESPN, KC. No problem with Indianapolis, 31-13. And moving on, AFC Championship game. They'll await the winner of that Chargers-Patriots game tomorrow. Rams right now just got a huge stop on fourth down, so they have possession. Driving near midfield, they lead Dallas 23-15 early on in the fourth quarter. About some top 25, couple scores for you. Gonzaga right now, number five in the country, 31-26 lead against San Francisco. And Duke, number one team, but lost to Gonzaga in the championship game of the Maui Classic, had their hands full. They hang on to win by two over number 13, Florida State, 80-78. Number three team in the country also winning today, Tennessee beat Florida, 78-67, and the number four team in the country, blowout win for Virginia. They win by 20 over the Clemson Tigers. Clemson Tigers, not quite as good in basketball as they were in football this year.
I'm sure.
Knights update for Ole, still 3-2. Blackhawks leading the Vegas Golden Knights, about 13 minutes left in regulation.
Oh, I better get on that. InfoWest Halftime Report in the books.
Oh, Jazz score for all our Jazz fans, 31-25. 9:59 left in the second quarter. Jazz, almost the exact score as we've got here at the half at the Burns Arena as they lead Chicago.
20 minutes up on the third quarter clock. Teams are going to switch sides. The Trailblazers will be moving left to right across your radio dial. Of course, that image is flipped for you TV and internet viewers with the camera on the other side of the court. On the floor for Dixie State, original starters. Matt Conway, Dub Price, Dason Youngblood, Zach Frampton, Quincy Matthews. Onto the floor for Chadron State. It will be Deshaun Jackson, Deontay Champion, Ruffin back onto the floor, Gavin, and Colby Jackson. Both teams, original starters. Dixie State going to be on defense to start things off. Chadron State, the first touch of the second half. Into Jason Jackson. Pressured right at half court, gets it across the timeline. Double team, passes out of it. Somehow, Dixie State not able to get a steal. And here's Ruffin, 20 to shoot. Now out to Colby Jackson, they'll reset.
Got to give Ruffin a little credit for coming to the ball, and Dub was behind him, and that allowed the pass to go through and keep this possession alive.
Colby Jackson with seven to shoot, right wing. Deshaun Jackson into Gavin, right-hand floater off the iron, no. Quincy the rebound. Great defense by Dixie State on that first defensive possession. Youngblood to Quincy, passes up a three, drives inside, runs over a defender, offensive foul.
Tough call against Q right there. You know, kind of tried to jump stop because he had tried to go all the way in earlier in the first half and got called for the charge. This time he thinks he's got a little crease there maybe to split the double team, but nice step up defense applied.
31-25, Dixie State within six. 19-14 to go on the second. Just underway here in half number two. Colby Jackson, Jeremy Ruffin. Baseline left side holding. Now puts the ball on the floor. Swings it to the right wing. He'll hand back off to Colby Jackson. Jackson, three-point land straight away into the corner. Ruffin lobbing, trying to lob into Gavin, but it's stolen by Matt Conway. Here comes Youngblood. Conway for three, straight away, and he'll knock it in. The steal, the three-point shot, Dixie State within three.
It's always nice to have a big guy that can trail, that can shoot like that. Matt Conway recognizing that, hey, his defender slacked off a little bit, and that shot was wide open.
18:30 to go in the second. Dixie State within three, 31-30. Ruffin kicking to the right wing. Jackson to Champion. Champion left wing with eight to shoot. It'll be the Champion, four to shoot. Free throw line jumper on the way, splashes it home.
Tough shot with a hand right in his face. Conway did his job and had a hand right in his face. That's a good shot.
Yeah, 4 of 6 for Champion from the floor. 3 rebounds, 2 assists, and 9 points tonight.
Frampton to Conway. Conway puts it on the floor. Leaves it with Quincy. 18-foot jumper right side, and it's in.
Big bucket for Q. Didn't hesitate. Can't second guess it. Even though he hasn't been shooting the way he'd like in his senior campaign, you got to pull the trigger when you're that open, and he buried it. Ripped the cores. Nothing but the bottom.
Trailblazers within three. 33-30. 17:42 to go here in the second. Champion hands off to Colby Jackson on the angle left side to Gavin, free throw line jumper. Totally banked it in.
You can live with that shot. That's just bank is open for business.
He's getting ready to say too strong, and he banked it in. Swinging by the ATM machine while the lobby's closed. Frampton to answer with the left wing three. Air ball. Conway going to chase the rebound down. Shot never hit iron, so the clock did not reset. 11 to shoot. Down to 10 and 9 and 7. And a foul inside. Youngblood is fouled. And we'll go against Colby Jackson, his second.
Still a two-possession game here for Dixie. You know, defensively, the first four possessions, they've got two stops. So they've made some good adjustments defensively. Offensively now, they just need to continue to attack. They can't be passive. They've got to do a better job of moving away from the ball. Those guys that don't have the ball have to be very active, move, cut, screen.
First free throw from Dayson Youngblood, up and in. He's got two. Cutting the lead to four.
Kind of fun that Dayson playing after Daylor graduated.
See a lot of similarities in
you
their
do.
Game, too.
Yeah.
I love
yeah.
it.
Daylor might have been a little longer.
Yeah.
A little taller.
Youngblood misses the second free throw. Chadron State the other way. They'll set up the offense. 16:48 to go. 17 seconds on the shot clock. Champion tried to cross over. Are they going to call a foul against Dub Price? Man, it looked like Champion had it. He tried to cross over, just dribbled it off his foot. And then Dub bumped into him. He just dribbled into his leg. 16:44 remaining. Back in play we go. Colby Jackson holding left corner and offensive foul. And it's going to be Gavin getting tangled up inside with Matt Conway.
Yeah, it's Colby Jackson looks at the official like, what did I do? I just caught the ball, but it was off ball. Gavin gets the personal foul. That's only his first. That's a good job when you're big into the second half, only picking up his first personal foul with 16 minutes and some change left.
Price holding. Will bounce to Conway, working on Gavin. Throws it up. No, but he'll get free throws.
And they come in spurts, don't they? Because there's foul number two on Gavin.
You go.
And that was pretty good defense, but he kind of leaned him out. He didn't leave him straight up, and I think that's why they call the foul.
You go 25 minutes without a foul called against you, and then bang, bang, in 30 seconds of game time, you pick up two fouls. And he'll check out. That will bring a doom bang back into the game.
You know, interesting move there for Chadron State to take him out with only two fouls. You know, he's not in foul trouble yet. Still a lot of basketball to be played, but, you know, he's been sitting a while. It's going to be tough for him to get his rhythm back. You're spending a lot of time on the bench. That's tough to come in and out like that.
Well, coach may be feeling like, hey, that's too quickly. But let's get him out. I don't know how long they'll wait here. Depends on probably if Dixie State can get it inside and exploit the size advantage in the paint.
That's right. Well, it won't be long before you see Julian Decree. You know, I'm sure any minute now he'll be entering the game.
Second free throw, no good. And Gavin's actually speaking with the trainer, the Chadron State trainer, about something, maybe some blood. Maybe that's why he checked out. Second free throw is no good. Dixie State within three, 35-32. 16:10 remaining in the second. Colby Jackson will bounce it to Bang, operating on the right block, spinning to the baseline, floating with the right and scoring. Good move by the big man.
Well, Conway was fronting the first two looks inside, but then they finally got it to Mbang, and that was a pretty shot.
Yep. 37-32, Chadron State a five-point lead. Conway to answer, left it short. Rebound to Chadron State. Champions got it. 15-43 remaining in the second. Colby Jackson, the near side champion. Skipping to Jayshon Jackson. 15 to shoot, Colby Jackson left wing. Kills the dribble, passes it, gets it right back. Holding on the left wing is Colby Jackson with seven. With five, here's Champion at the free throw line. Step back jumper, Quincy a hand in his face. Missed it, offensive rebound, Bang. And he's fouled. Frampton took it right out of his hands.
Yeah, and
but is going to be called for a foul.
I'm not sure if somebody missed putting a body on, but that Champion's taking a little 17-foot jumper. Shot clock's winding down. Again, that's what haunted Dixie State a little bit. Nobody gets a body, and then Frampton tries to steal it once he comes down with it and gets caught with a ticky-tack variety foul.
15-16 to go. Dixie State trailing 37-32. 60-second timeout and back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
There is a place where the sun doesn't hide in the winter, where the greens stay green and the crimson canyons still glow. There is a place where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where we drive for show, putt for dough, and settle the score with another round. There is a place.
I'm Jimmy. This is my definition of fresh since 1983.
15-16 remaining. Dixie State within 5, 37-32. Zach Frampton picking up the foul just before the break. Trailblazers looking at a couple things. Within 5, but 8 of 15 from the free throw line, 53%. That certainly won't help. Chadron State with possession. It'll be Champion. Over to Deshaun Jackson. Chadron State definitely doesn't have a problem being patient about what they want to do. They eat the entire shot clock almost every possession. Jayshon Jackson. Delamont loses.
Which means Dixie State's got to value their offensive possessions.
Andrew. One more pass inside. A Champion missed the layup. Dixie State the rebound. Champion a great look, but he missed it. Dixie State will take it, though. Frampton to Quincy. Thought about a three. Decided against it, and then tried to force a pass into Dub. Turned it over.
Sometimes you can be a little bit too unselfish, too close to quarters to try that bounce pass.
37-32, Dixie State within five. Delamont. Champion, free throw line, lobs in, Bang, catches, scores, goaltending.
Really good entry pass down low.
Would have gone in, but Conway pulled it off the glass. Bang has 6 points, and the lead is back out to 7.
Yeah, you got to be careful. Dixie's got to control this run a little bit. Chadron State going on a little bit of run. The best way to do that is points in the key or a free throw. Get it inside, get an easy bucket, or get to the free throw line.
Pagan Koff back into the game. Kicks it out. Dub Price for three. Straight away, Bang.
That works too.
That works too. Nothing but the bottom there for Dub. Not necessarily his game, but filling that one, let it fly, and you like it. You don't want to pass up a three like that, but too easy on the other end for Shatter as they get the lay-in.
Yeah, Bang lays it up and in. Lead back to 6, 41-35. Frampton is fouled away from the ball. And it will go against Champion, his second. Julian Decree up off the bench. He will check in for Matt Conway. Can he provide the same spark here in the second that he did in the first?
If he lets it come to him, don't try to force the issue. Don't try to pick right up where he left off. You know, keep playing good defense and then let your teammates enter into the block and get you some good looks.
The Price 10-foot jumper rims out. Julian Decree, offensive rebound. He's going to get called for a foul.
Maybe Julian wrapped him second. A little bit from the backside or just tried to hold him with the arm. I couldn't tell. Take a look on the replay. Julian wrapping him?
Giving him a little.
He's just holding his ground, but there is contact.
Delamont for three the other way. Way too strong. Wade Miller, he's into the game. Snares the rebound. Hand off to Frampton. Six-point game. Wade, catch and shoot three. Left wing, no. Chases down the rebound. Saves it in to Decree, driving the end line. Off the window, no, but he's fouled. Two free throws coming. And it will go against Bang. Well, his second.
Bubba off balance on that triple, but tracked it down and then saves it. Julian, I like it. Just power dribble. Don't be denied. You've got the size advantage.
Yeah, he's definitely a tough guard when he's that close to the basket. Does a good job off the dribble. You know, anytime you can see a big guy take it from the corner to the basket that quickly and that well, it's good.
Decree makes the free throw. He's at 10 points. Second one missed it. Chadron State the rebound.
Just 9 for 6, 17 from the line tonight for the Trailblazers.
Fourth time Julian Decree has hit double digits this season. Deshaun Jackson for Chadron State to Andrew on a 15-second shot clock. 41-36, Dixie State within 5. Delamont, right corner 3, no. Halfway down, pop back out. Julian Decree the rebound, hand off to Pagankoff. Jack weaving in and out. Leads for Frampton. Back to Pagankoff. Driving in the lane to Decree. Oh, boy. He's going to get called for an offensive foul. And that will be his third.
Again, I think, Mike, you pointed out in the first half, once you catch on that block, even if that double team comes quickly, hold it high and wait a little bit. Let your players outside move to get an open three, and then you can kick it back out. I think Julian a little too quick there and just bowled his way in and got caught.
12:39 remaining, Dixie State. Within 5, 41-36. Jayshon Jackson swinging it over to Champion. Skip pass to Andrew, left wing. Bouncing inside to Bang. Bang, floater, no. Dub Price rebound, and he's fouled by Jayshon Jackson. His second.
Trailblazers have been better on the glass in the second half. Hard fought rebound, but Dub held his position. Went and got there first, and that forced the foul. It's 16 fouls now on the Eagles. Just 5 for the Trailblazers.
Pagankoff. They give him space. Pulls the trigger on a 3. It rims out. And good boxing out by Chadron State. No way any white jerseys were getting in there. Here come the Eagles.
Double foul.
And we've got a double foul against Bang and Julian Decree. And that is going to be Decree's fourth.
Now that's not good because he was the guy that provided the big spark in the first half with 9 points.
Referee's still having a discussion. In the lane.
I'd like to see Pagankoff get another look at three. He's an excellent three-point shooter. Had that one just kind of pop back out, not far off the mark. But you don't need threes right now. There's so much game left. You still got to try to go inside out, I believe.
You're right, Devin. I think if Dixie can somehow get the lead here, I think that momentum will shift. They just need to get that lead. They need to taste it one time and then go on a big run.
Yeah, trailed by as many as 17, have never led. You're right.
You're under 12. Colby Jackson to Delamont. Left wing 3. He missed his last 2 or 3. Didn't miss that one. Knocks it in. He's got 8. The lead is 8. Wilson feeds Price. Right block. Back to Wilson. Now to Conway. Left block. Conway forcing it up. Good. And 1.
Well, a little bit more patient set there, you know, where Julian got in a little trouble as he was too quick. That time, Conway felt the double team, still knew he had possession and split the double team not a lot of contact, but enough to draw the whistle and the and one opportunity when we come back.
Dixie State within six. Can Matt Conway make it five? We'll find out after this timeout. 44-38, 11:38 to go in the second. We take the 60-second timeout. Come right back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network. Kiskin. 11:38 to go. Dixie State within six after the Matt Conway layup. Can he convert three the old-fashioned way? 44-38. Conway at the line for a free throw. He's got eight tonight, trying to make it nine with the free throw.
Yeah, Conway on the season, been there a lot, 64-79, so 81%. So an excellent free throw shooter. And we got a cheerleader down. Somebody got injured, Carrick, and there's a little bit of a stoppage here before. So they're going to clear the teams back to their bench while they attend to an incident. Kelby Hoffine's over there taking a look, the trainer.
Never what you want to see. Bruno and Kelby.
Yeah, Bruno's the one that's kind of checking.
We got Dean of Students, Dale Beatty, involved. There.
Boy. Dixie State within six, 44-38. It'll be Matt Conway at the free throw line out of the timeout. Mike, 11:38 to go. Dixie State needs something. They need anything. How do they do it? What do they got to do here to spark this thing and get it flipped the other way?
Well, I think the first thing is going to start on the defensive end. Earlier on, we've all talked about how that defense leads to offense. If they could pick up three consecutive stops, that's what they're looking for. They can get three consecutive stops and then just be patient offensively. There's so much time left in the game. Still a two-possession game. Three consecutive stops, be patient, run your offense.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, you look at the points off turnovers, 16 for Dixie State to 8 for the Eagles. But points in the paint, big advantage for Chadron. They've got 20-8 advantage in that category.
Conway, couple of dribbles. Free throw on the way, and he missed it. It was in and popped out. 6-point game, and been that kind of night for Dixie State, just kind of all around. Chadron State the other way, Delamont another three, left wing, no. Wade Miller the rebound. Here comes Dixie on the run. Pagankoff to Wilson, spot up three, left wing, bang!
Nothing but the bottom there. I like how Pagankoff got to the middle, created a nice passing lane to the wing for the wide open three, and Wilson made them pay.
44-41, Dixie State within three, 11:08 remaining. Walker, the champion. Jackson, bouncing to Walker at the free throw line. And an offensive foul going to be called, I believe, against Bang inside. Yes, it will be. It'll be his third.
Not sure if
with
Bang
that,
was
here
just,
comes the big man.
I think he was just trying to hold for position, but got a little too much of a push, and that's what drew the whistle.
With that, Charles Gavin back in.
Well, that's the second stop. You know, we talked about Dixie getting three. That's the second.
There's Pagankoff. Trailblazers could tie with a three on this possession. Wilson, a deep two. That'll play, too. He's got eight. Dixie State within one, 44-43. Colby Jackson to Delamont. Skip pass to the right wing and champion. Champion to Jackson. Walker, free throw line to Delamont. Driving inside. Leaner, no. Tapped out. Pagankoff has the rebound for Dixie State. Pushing it up the floor. Leaves it with Dub Price for three, right wing. No, off the left wing, off the left side. And it goes right to Chadron State. A chance to take the lead. And that one was off the left side. One of those high-risk, high-reward shots.
I like the look, though, by Pagenkopf. I mean, he left it for him perfectly.
Gavin the other way, and he'll score. He's got nine. Chadron State lead is three, 46-43. Coach Judkins pleading with the official, saying that Gavin carried that ball. And he's going to another official. He's trying to get the word out. And now an offensive foul against Matt Conway, his first.
Now, there's still plenty of time to go. 9:38 to go, 43-46. You know, they've chipped into this lead slowly, and they're doing it on the defensive end. You know, they're getting the stops. They just need to capitalize, be a little bit more patient on offense.
Jordan Mills into the game. He'll give to Ruffin. Ruffin far side to Jackson. That's just a Ruffin inside Mills. No. Rebound, Wilson. Here comes Pagenkopf. Pagenkopf to Conway. Trailer three. No. Rebound, Chadron State. Colby Jackson the other way. Gives to Ruffin. Out of Mills. Inside Ruffin working on Wilson. And it's knocked out of his hands and out of bounds. Chadron State will maintain the possession.
That's a good look on that last offensive possession by Conway, but Trailblazers now cooling off a little bit. 6 of 15 from downtown, right at 40% from the three-point field and from the field. They're 14 of 35 tonight and only 9 of 18, 50% from the free throw line. And yet they still got a chance to win this thing.
Colby Jackson with 10 to shoot for Chadron State. Shot clock did not reset. Here's Champion with five. I'm not sure if they see it. Ruffin with two, and that's going to be a shot clock violation. No, they didn't call the shot clock violation, but the shot was off. Here comes Dixie State the other way. Tapped out of bounds. Trailblazers have it.
Now, it's been a while where Dixie State has really been patient on offense, where they've been able to run their stuff. We've seen two quick threes early in the shot clock. Good looks, but looks that you can get at any time in the shot clock. So look for Dixie to be a little bit more patient here and run their stuff.
There's Youngblood to Wade Miller, left wing, driving inside, off the window and in. Couple bounces off the rim as well. He's got five. Dixie State within one. Chadron State quickly the other way. Champion, no, but he leans in on Wade Miller and draws the contact. He'll get free throws.
Yeah, tough call against Miller, but you know that's what good offensive scorers do. A little shoulder dip, create that contact, fade off of it. Try to get the and one.
They almost did. Champion to the line for a pair of free throws. Just a 60% free throw shooter. First one, good.
And Champion, the first Eagle in double figures tonight. I mean, it's been a balanced scoring attack. He's got 10. Gavin's got 9. 8 from Delamont. 7 from Jackson, Colby Jackson.
Second free throw, good. It's the last time I mentioned someone's free throw percentage. He makes them both. 48-45, Dixie State within three. 8:15 to go. There's Youngblood to the right side and Miller. Inside Julian Decree back in with four fouls. Youngblood to Wilson, left wing. Driving inside, reverse from left to right, it rimmed out. Matt Conway, offensive rebound, he's fouled, going back up.
That's what happens when Julian Decree's unselfish. The only thing he did wrong there is he didn't repost, but if he does, he might clog it up. That allowed Wilson to drive. And then finally, somebody crashing that offensive glass is Matt Conway.
7:58 to go. Dixie State within three. Conway free throws after the break. TV, keep it here for a sideline report with Kyler Young. Radio, 60-second timeout and back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network. Get set.
Was step up the defense. A big part of that was the offensive rebounding and second chance points that they allowed. 8 offensive rebounds, 9 second chance points in that first half. Well, let's take a look and see how they're doing now. Only 1 offensive rebound that they've allowed now, leading to 0 second chance points. So I'd say they're doing pretty good here in the second half.
Oh,
7:58 to play. Dixie State trailing 48-45. Matt Conway at the stripe for a pair of free throws. Conway with 8 points tonight. Can reach double digits with a couple of makes here. Takes his time. First one, no good. It rimmed out.
They just can't get over the hump. You know, they get so close. Opportunities right there. They just can't get it. I got a feeling as soon as they taste that lead, they're really going to take off.
Trailblazers 6 of 15 from the stripe tonight. Excuse me. 9 of 19. Conway makes the second. He's got 9. The first number I read was the three-point shooting.
Quincy coming in. Hasn't had a lot of minutes in the second half. See if Q can provide a little bit of spark. Like we're talking about in pregame, Quincy can help you just as much or more defensively than offensively and really help you on the glass.
48-46, Dixie State within two. Got to have some stops. 7:45 remaining. Ruffin. He'll swing it to Colby Jackson. Quickly to Mills in the left corner. Mills to Champion. Puts the ball on the floor. Driving. Forces. No. Mills offensive rebound. Throws it back out. That never hit the shot. The rim.
Juddy knows. He's letting the officials know that he thinks it should be a violation.
They're going to drop it down to 8.
Did it hit the rim or not? I'd like to see that again. A good defense by Quincy. Somebody didn't box out Mills, though. Does it graze the back of the rim?
8 seconds.
Hard to tell from that angle. Here we go. Down to 5. Here's Colby Jackson. Throws it up. He's going to be bailed out with a foul.
Yeah, nobody came over to help on the D. He kind of lost his footing. Looked like Quincy was just trying to give ground. Wasn't trying to bump him there. Because he fell down, I think that's what forced the official to feel like there was a foul there. What'd you see, Mike?
The exact same thing, Dev. Kind of a ticky-tack. It looked like he lost his balance a little bit.
Jackson makes the first free throw. I felt like there might have been a little contact out near the elbow.
Yeah.
And that's where he started to get tripped up. And then he threw it up inside. So for me, I guess you got double. You got one and one is the situation, though. So never mind. I'll back up. Open mouth, insert foot. He makes both free throws. And he's got 9 points, and it's a 4-point lead again. Conway, Quincy Matthews, Zach Frampton. To Wilson, right elbow jumper, no. Colby Jackson rebound for Chadron State. Well, you get the feeling Dixie State got to have some stops here, and Champion the other way, he puts it in, 6-point lead.
Yeah, and they're really running the offense through Champion with Sparks injured, and he's provided a lift in the second half.
Frampton to Conway, and to Ducree, to Quincy, left corner. Trying to find Ducree, nothing there. At the Frampton, 10 to shoot. Now to Ducree, one-on-one with Gavin. Drives inside, reverse, scoop and score, left to right. Julian Ducree's got 12. Champion quickly up the other way. Dixie State almost didn't get back in time. 6:20 to go. Dixie State within 4, 52-48. Fadeaway jumper and good. Jeremy Ruffin. Big shot for Chadron State. 54-48. Dixie State trails by 6. Coach Judkins wants timeout. 6 minutes remaining. We'll keep it right here. 54-48. They're saying it is going to be a full timeout. First coach's call timeout of the second half. So never mind. Let's take it. Full timeout, we'll take it. 6 minutes to go. Dixie State trailing by 6. 60-second timeout back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
At Kneaders, we start simple, making bread from scratch with just a handful of ingredients. It's not the easy way, but it's worth it. Honest bread made without shortcuts. When you come to Kneaders, every loaf of bread, every sandwich, starts here. Yes, it takes more time, but that's why we get an early start.
Stop by today for dine-in, takeout, or drive-through.
Welcome back inside the Burns Arena. Dixie State trailing 54-48. 6 minutes remaining. Trailblazers with possession. A little bit of stoppage of play as they get some things sorted out on the scorers table. But the Trailblazers will have possession out of this timeout, looking to try to cut into this six-point lead. Devin, what do you want to see on this possession for Dixie State?
Well, continue to find ways to make buckets if you can in the paint, but shooting it better in the second half, 47%, 3-8 in from the downtown stripe here in half number two. 45% from Chadron on the road, though, and 1-4 from downtown. They've continued to try to pound it in the post. They shot a lot more three-pointers in the first half.
Wilson inside. He's fouled. Was it on the shot? Not going to matter. Two free throws coming. It's double bonus. And it will go against Gavin, his
third. And you go back to, you know, when Dixie State was getting hammered, they were down like 28-12 early in the second half on the boards. They've started to chip away, 35-22. Still a big disadvantage in the rebounding. They got to continue to limit the Eagles to one shot. Chadron obviously wants to continue to do the same thing, especially on the defensive glass. You don't want to give up second chance points.
No, and it's critical that they put together a string of stops defensively, whether it's through the press or slowing them down or missed shots, whatever it is. They have to get a string of stops together where they can get the lead. It's all going to be defense. Their offense will come. They've just got to be patient and keep playing together. There's got to be good movement, good action defensively, and good collective team offense.
Both free throws in for Andre Wilson. He's got 10.
And eight of those coming in half number two. He's been a spark scoring in the second half.
54-50, Dixie State. Down by four, nearly had a turnover, tapped away. Champion off of his leg, should be Dixie State ball.
No, they say no. Eagles possession.
Wow, it looked like it might have gone off of the Eagles, but of course I'm clear down here, so what can I see? Here's another look at it, it went off of Champion's leg. They're going to get a gift. Mills is going to take advantage of it. Knocks it in. Hard to see that in live action. Dixie State trailing by six, 56-50. Frampton with it. 5:05 remaining. Conway driving inside, and they're going to call a travel.
NFL game, Hearst Ace Hardware update for all our listeners. Rams, 30-22 win. And they'll await the winner of that Philadelphia-New Orleans Saints game tomorrow. Well, both those games for you on ESPN Radio if you're out and about on your Sunday.
4:53 remaining. Dixie State trailing by six. It's crucial. Got to get stops here. Here's Ruffin. Fadeaway jumper, another one, no, offensive rebound. And then Frampton is cleared out, and they're going to call a blocking foul against Frampton because he's in the restricted area, I'm assuming. It looked like there might have been.
They caught him across the arm. I think he said he got him on the arm. And that looked like on the replay the right call.
Yeah.
Again, a little bit of a breakdown. They're not putting bodies and boxing them out of the lane. They're allowing these guys to cut through and go crash the glass. And you got to give the Eagles a lot of credit. Even though they didn't convert on that first free throw attempt, they're giving themselves more chances to push this lead ahead. Still a long way to go. That rebounding deficit has been a big factor tonight.
Yeah, it's been the difference, really. It's That difference has been critical. Offensive, defensively, the Eagles crash extremely hard. They're athletic, they're smart, and they go after the boards hard.
Missed both free throws, offensive rebound. Deshaun Jackson misses the putback, tipped again, and then another offensive rebound, tipped, stolen away. Dixie State has it. After all that, they get the ball back in a hand check foul on the way back up the floor. We'll send Andre Wilson to the free throw line for two free throws.
Pretty fortunate for the Trailblazers to escape unscathed on that possession.
My, oh my.
Not one, not two, but three different looks there before they get the deflection. And now you put Wilson on the line, a chance to inch a little bit closer. This last 425, Trailblazers want to kind of stretch it out. They'd love to get to the line as much as possible.
First one, no good. Left it short. Got to make him, though, if you're going to get there.
Good point. Just a little bump, though. And kind of a touch foul. But what did you say earlier, Mike? Freedom of movement.
Freedom of movement, man. If I had a nickel for every time I heard an official say that this year, we wouldn't be sitting here.
Wilson makes the second free throw. He's got 11. Dixie State within 5. 4:20 remaining. Pagankoff kicks it out of bounds. Chadron State will maintain the possession. 4:19 to play.
You know, Pagankoff was kind of on a little bit of a pitch count minutes-wise last night. He's played 13 minutes tonight, and Juddy going with him here down the stretch. Good to see him back nearly 100%. I don't know if he's fully there, but he's close.
We did a great job of managing the game when they went on that run. Very smart, getting the ball in the right place.
Here's Mills driving inside, high off the window, and he gets it to go. Boy, Jordan Mills has come out of nowhere with a couple of big buckets.
Yeah, Julian a little late to come over on the help side defense. And
Wilson passing, knocked away. Dixie State will chase it down. Wilson again, Trailblazers trailing by 7. Ducree, no. Quincy Matthews, offensive rebound, put back, no. Chadron State the rebound. 3:45 to play, here's Champion. He's fouled, free throw's coming.
Gotta stop the ball. You know, they got the rebound, went coast to coast. Nobody picked up the ball for Dixie State, and it took it right to the rim.
Now against Quincy Matthews, 58-51. 3:42 to go. Dixie State got to dig in deep to try for this one. 60-second timeout and back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
Call it a path or way through. It can be arrow straight or have twists and turns. It's life's financial journey, and Mountain America Credit Union is here to guide you every step of the way. With timely advice and affordable products, this is your journey. Let's begin together. We're Mountain America, guiding you forward.
So we have to be responsible ourselves for our minds.
True, right? We can't palm it off
on being unwitting dupes and just say, oh, well, it doesn't count because I got played.
Well, we have some unwitting dupes, Jennifer.
We do, but you can't say because we got played by the Russians that we have to redo the election.
.342 to go, Dixie State trailing 58-51. And free throws coming for Chadron State and Deontay Champion. Couple of big ones here. It's a 7-point game. He makes these, it's out to 9. Misses the first.
Chadron now 7 of 13 from the free throw line, right at 53%, 53.8% to be precise. Dixie State only 54%, so pretty even.
Missed the second. Offensive rebound, ball tied up, going back to Dixie State.
Well, that's the third offensive rebound.
Alternate possession arrow.
Third offensive rebound.
On a free throw.
not only by a free throw, but by the point guard on a free throw.
Trailblazers have it. To the point where you, trailing seven, absolutely have to score on pretty much every possession here on out. Wilson for three, left corner. Bang!
Oh, Wilson's been so good in the second half. They needed every one of his points. Now 14 on the night.
4-point game, 58-54. Jefferson, the champion, right wing, 3:10 remaining. Mills pulls up, left elbow jumper, another big one. Boy, Jordan Mills averages 2.2 points per game, and he's got three buckets here in the second half that have really changed the game. Pagankoff, 2:50 remaining. Dub Price will jump it from 10 feet, no. Rebound, Chadron.
And only one Dixie State Trailblazer underneath trying to get an offensive rebound, and that ball carrying back out to the middle where they had all Eagles.
Knocked away. Mills with it, harassed by Wilson. Now he gets past him, kicks to the corner. Jayshon Jackson, he'll bounce inside Jefferson. Floats, no. Dub Price the rebound. Hands off to Pagankoff. 6-point game. Quincy driving inside, off the window, no, but a foul.
Good hard attack by Q right there. Could have took a deep two, instead put one power dribble down and said, I'm gonna try to get all the way to the lane. And late whistle, but it came as it was kind of stripped away and got hit on the arm. Quincy's good at finishing from both the right and side. We haven't seen a lot of it this year. Had some earlier injuries, but he can do it.
First free throw
good
is up for
good. Good to see him hit a free throw, too, because only 9 of 21 now from the stripe on the season, and he's a much better free throw shooter than that. It's just a concentration thing.
That's right. Well, you got to score with the clock stop, right? These are big.
Second one is good. Dixie State going to take a timeout. Back within four. Trailblazers trailing 60-56, 2:11 to play. 30-second timeout. Let's keep it right here and continue to try to break this thing down. Trailblazers within four, got to have a stop. What's Coach Judkin saying in the huddle right now, Mike?
Exactly what you just said, guys. We got to get a stop. He's got to get two or three of them right in a row. You've got to have consecutive stops. If you want momentum, you've got to stop them from scoring. So probably change defense a little bit. Try some things to get your guys moving a little bit. Keep them sharp. But it's very imperative that they get two or three consecutive stops.
Yeah, and rebound. I mean, rebound. Obviously, that's been the Achilles heel tonight for Dixie State. I mean, too many opportunities for Chadron. And give Chadron State credit. I mean, they have been a concerted effort to hit the glass hard, and that's a big reason why they got the lead. And a couple key second-chance putbacks here either way could tilt this game here with 2:09 to play.
That's right.
Pass ahead to Champion. Champion to the far side and Mills. Man, he's had big shots. Drives inside. Floats it up. No. Dixie State's got the stop. It's Pagankoff across the timeline. Leaving for Frampton. And Jack Pagankoff is knocked to the ground. And it will be against Jordan Mills. That will send Pagankoff to the line for a pair of free throws.
That's a heady play. Pagankoff just stopped. Mills just kind of said, I'm just going to glide kind of into you, and then Pagankoff goes down. And official really doesn't have a choice there but to blow the whistle.
Oh, you're right. But
they're going to look at it, they said. Not sure what exactly they want to see.
Too bad he can't shoot his free throws first.
Well, I don't think there was anything malicious. I just think he kind of set a pick with his back to Mills, but his feet were planted.
Yeah, and Mills wasn't even looking. You know, it's hard for Mills to even see him. But Dixie got their first stop. We're going to put together a run. They got their first stop. Offensively, they've done a good job of getting to the free throw line.
Yeah, clearly a foul on Mills. I'm not sure. I think it's just a common foul. I don't think there's anything flagrant to you, Mike.
No.
They wouldn't be going to see if it was actually a foul, right? There's no way they take
that
away.
They're looking to see if it's flagrant or if he extended the elbow or maybe. I mean, Pagankoff definitely leans towards him to initiate, but his feet are planted. He's not moving. And now we'll get the word from our officials on what the foul is, what the call is. No, we won't. Quick conversation. And I think it's just going to be normal,
just
personal foul.
Just common
those.
Foul.
Common foul. Give Coach Judkins an opportunity to set up some defensive strategy here and to get his guys on the same page. It's just under 2 minutes to go.
Of course, Jack had to think about those free throws for a second longer, but. And Hagen caught the line for a couple of big, big free throws. He missed the first.
I almost got too quiet in here for a second as he shot that.
He'll have one more to try to cut it to a three-point game with 1:50 remaining. Second one, missed it. And lane violation, trying to get his own rebound.
He knew he missed that as soon as he shot it. He shot that and took off a little bit too early.
15 of 28 from the free throw line for Dixie State in a four-point game. Shades of a couple seasons ago. Colby Jackson to the near side and champion, 1:30 remaining. Colby Jackson. Gavin, the champion, 9 seconds on the shot clock. Down to 5 and 4. He'll drive inside. Layup, no. Offensive putback, good.
Wow, they got the stop.
Walker Andrew.
1 second on the shot clock when he scored that. They had their stop, gave up an offensive rebound.
62-56, 1:14 remaining. It'll be a 30-second timeout. Trailblazers may be in a little bit of trouble. Let's take it. 30-second timeout, just a quick 30, right back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
I take the road less traveled, run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine, pouring on me. Think I might just stay a while.
One 14 remaining. Dixie State trailing by 6, 62-54, and it's stolen away. But Dixie State has got it back. 106 remaining, and Zach Frampton is fouled. Wow. Chadron State going for the steal. They had it, but momentum was carrying him out of bounds, so he had to chunk it back. Dixie State able to track back and pick it up, and Zach Frampton fouled on his way up the floor. 104 remaining, Dixie State trailing by 6, 62-56. First free throw, good.
Big free throw. Dixie State with one timeout to go, minute 4 seconds. Coach Judkins will be very strategic about when he uses that. You always want to have one in the back in case you need to drop a game winner.
Second free throw, no. Ball is loose. Dub Price has got it. He's fouled. Two free throws.
Oh, the brute force, the strength. I mean, Dub just wanted that ball more and somehow fought his way into the middle of the key, threw a box out. That was a pretty good effort on the box out. Dub just got to the middle, a little bit of strength there. Dub's come a long ways. You're watching Dub's progression from when he was, you know, freshman, sophomore, now to an upperclassman. It's been fun to see.
Dub Price. First free throw is good. He's got 4. Dixie State within 4.
Just kind of used his arm to kind of keep it in the middle and then finally went and got it once he shed the box out.
Second free throw, good. 3-point game. 102 remaining. You get a stop here. Things are going to get interesting. Colby Jackson. To the right wing, chance of defense raining down. Here's Jackson, 47 on the game clock, 14 on the shot. To Walker. Jackson. Drives inside, he traveled. And they're gonna call it, travel. Wade Miller going to check in, putting an extra three-point shooter on the floor. Great defense. Dub Price and Dayson Youngblood forcing him to change his direction. He traveled.
Well, Youngblood did a very good job of keeping him in front of him and did a good job of not letting him get around him. Kept him in front, and that double team kind of scared him just enough to spook the travel.
Dixie State going to take a timeout, 62-59. It's a 30-second. We keep it right here. 35.7 seconds. No, it's going to be a full timeout. Let's do this. We don't want to miss any of the action. 62-59, 35.7 seconds remaining. A 30-second, just a 30, and right back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
Radio Dixie, 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this. I need a one dance. And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
Welcome back inside the Burns Arena, Dixie State. Within three, 62-59, with 35.7 seconds remaining. And possession. They'll have to go the full length of the floor. Coaches reminding their players, we are out of timeouts.
Well, if you look at Dixie, you've got five guys in there that can shoot. You know, good move by Coach Judkins to have all the shooters on the floor.
Frampton to Wilson, clock begins. Wilson across the timeline, 30 seconds remaining. Will bounce to Frampton. Zach passing in the end line to Andre Wilson. It's fouled on a three-point attempt from the right wing with 22.5 seconds remaining.
Well, you definitely didn't want to do that. You didn't want to stop the clock because now there's 22 seconds left like you just mentioned. And even if you only get two or three, you can play the foul game and draw this out. This puts Dixie State right back in it. Didn't need the three. What an effort on the pass to the corner, then the extra pass to the wing, and clearly a foul.
First free throw is good. 62-60.
You know, it's interesting. 22 seconds to go. It looks like Chadron State has two timeouts. Interesting that they're not using one here to ice Andre.
Second free throw. Good. Andre Wilson with 16 points.
I was just going to say, he's been clutch tonight. Is that a season high for him?
Third free throw, missed it. And they foul, well, no, they're not trying to foul. They're trying to get a steal. And Dump Price thought he had the ball tied up. He's going to be called for a foul. In a one-point game, 62-61.
Dub this
they're
season.
They're putting an 87% free throw shooter at the line.
But you will have a chance. Ball in your hands, 15 seconds. Chance to tie, win.
Makes the first free throw like it was nothing. 10 points for Colby Jackson.
Yeah, well, five assists too. I like his floor game. He's a distributor, doesn't have to just score to be an effective player.
Love a miss here and then maybe try to go for the win.
Well, you've seen Dixie give up three offensive rebounds from free throws, so they've got to block off.
Second free throw, good. 3-point game.
Now you probably want to take the three. You need a good look, though. You got time to set up.
Chadron State has the option to foul should they choose.
No timeout.
Here's Pagankoff to Wade Miller to Dub for three. No. Ball is loose. Chadron's got it. 4.8 seconds remaining. Coach Reed asking for an intentional foul. That's not going to get that.
You know, Bubba came off the curl. Just great defense. He has to kick it to Dub, and Dub felt like he needed to take that shot.
Well, Devin, we go back to the first half. You talked about Gavin being a 50% free throw shooter. You know, hopefully they can get a miss. If they can get misses here, they still have a chance. 4.8 seconds is plenty of time to get a shot off.
First one, miss.
Yeah,
you got a rebound.
And it's a pressure-packed free throw. It's not an easy one for a 50% free throw shooter.
You may see an automatic foul, though.
Yeah.
As soon as that's
what I would do. I mean, Dixie gets the ball, you give up a couple dribbles and a foul.
Second free throw, missed it. Wade Miller ahead to Wilson. Wilson with two, with one for the tie. No. Chadron State has held on to win.
Really good D on Wilson there. Didn't foul, went straight up. Forced a tough shot in transition with less than a second on the clock. Got it off in time, just wasn't there. And he needed the misses, you got him. But no timeouts left, kind of hurts you. You get that timeout on that rebound, you advance the ball up and you can draw a set play, but not having that TO hurt.
It did.
64-61, let's go to a 60-second timeout on radio TV. Kylie Young has Coach Judkins.
Coach, you brought it back within 3 points, a minute left to go. What was your game plan, and what did you feel they executed well, and what did you want to see happen?
We waited too long to try to win a game. I don't know what they're waiting for. I thought they didn't. To me, it's like you got to go out and get it. You can't hope to win. And tonight I thought we were hoping that they made a mistake instead of us taking it. But we fought hard, but it was the way we started the game was how it ended up. And you can't do that to a good team like this. So something we have to learn. We had chances. We missed foul shots at the end. We just got to do a better job of finishing games.
How do you bounce back after this one as you go on a long road trip?
I don't know. It's going to be hard. It just seems like we play really good and then we play really bad. So if we're going to keep doing that, I guess our next game is going to be a really good one. But these ones sting. You know, these ones sting, and we got to get better and smarter.
Well, thanks, Coach.
Welcome back inside the Burns Arena. Dixie State falling 64-61 in what turned into be a thriller. And Trailblazers fall by three. Dixie State dropping to 5-8 overall, 3-6 in the RMAC. And Carrick Sagmiller, Mike Olson, Devin Dixon here with us inside the Burns Arena. And this is a tough one. You hate to lose at home. You hate to lose it all. But you hate to lose at home. And unfortunately, we got to break down a loss here in the postgame show tonight. And the first thing you got to look at is you still had a chance, even though you left 14 points at the free throw line. Not a great night from the field. Just not sure what it was tonight. Just not even hit the shots. Good defense by Chadron State. But a tough one. And this one will hurt a little bit in terms of trying to fight your way back and trying to at least get in that RMAC tournament.
Well, I don't think it's one thing. I think it's a combination of a few things. And first thing you look at is 37% field goals for the game. They didn't shoot the ball real well. And defensively, you know, they weren't responding. Give Chadron State credit. They answered the bell at every Dixie State run. They had the poise. They had that we're not going to lose mentality. And did everything that it took. Guys coming off the bench and starters. That was a team that was hungry, a team that just refused to lose. For Dixie State, you know, the effort was there at times, and you love their grit to come back and put themselves in a position to tie it. That they played very hard, didn't play it as smart as they probably could have at times, but great effort in a tough loss.
Yeah, you just felt like from the get-go, shots were not dropping. This is a new conference. They're not necessarily used to playing back-to-back. Pac West didn't play. You know, you'd have a homestand where you'd play, you know, a Thursday, a Saturday, and a Monday. You always have that day of rest. And I don't know how hard of adjustment that is. I've never played the RMAC schedule, but it seems to be kind of tricky. You know, plus you're going to, you know, new places. But no excuse. No excuse. And Juddy will tell you that. This is their home court. They didn't play well enough to win. The rebounding deficit, 47-26. I mean, 19 more rebounds. That equates to a lot more offensive chances for Chadron State, and they took advantage. And, you know, when one of their stars goes down in a game with a nasty injury, Michael Sparks, guys like Mills came in and gave him a little bit of a lift off the bench. And Delmont hit some buckets, and some of those guys off the bench really provided, you know, more than just point production, and they made Dixie State work for every single bucket tonight. Buckets were hard to come by. It was a relatively lower scoring game. I mean, Dixie State held to, what, 12, 13 points below their season average at home. That doesn't happen very often, and I thought the defense was good enough to win tonight. I really did. I just think the offense kind of let them down, and Coach Judkins can look at this and say, why do we do this in a game when we don't do this all week of practice? He probably had a really good week of practice, but he can't go make shots for guys, and shots just weren't falling tonight. And points in the paint killed them on defense. There was a lot of, 30 points in the paint tonight for the Eagles to just 12 for Dixie State.
You mentioned one guy in particular, Jordan Mills. I mean, his stat line doesn't look all that gaudy. He's 3 for 8, but he finishes with 6 points. You want to talk about a guy that answered the Dixie State big baskets. Every time Dixie State would come down and hit a three. Every, like, 3 or 4 different times in a row, it was Jordan Mills on the other end, a guy that only averages 2 points per game, probably wasn't even on the scouting report, and he was the one that ends up hurting you in the long run. And that's what good teams do. That's what great teams do, is you lift one another, and those were big shots. So if I'm his teammates, I'm giving him a big-time high five and a slap on the back tonight in the locker room, because for me, that was a huge difference maker for Chadron State down the stretch. So much focus on some of those other guys, and Mills was able to make those big shots, and that's what, you know, good team efforts are able to do. And, you know, Dixie State will have to try to bounce back from this one, because it doesn't get any easier. You're on the road for four in a row after this one, and you're not back inside the Burns until that first weekend in February.
Yeah, and guys off the bench like Walker Andrews, 6 rebounds, 8 for Champion, you know, 7 for Gavin. Like, again, these guys attack. They're relentless. They're now 5-4 in conference. Dixie State drops to 3-6. And, boy, the pressure kind of starts to mount. You know, you really needed to win both these home games this weekend, try to inch closer to 500 instead. You're 3 below 500 now with, like you mentioned, that road stretch ahead. That's a tough spot to be in. You're missing Chatwin. You're missing Austin Montgomery. You still don't have Pagan Koff for, you know, extended minutes tonight. How many did Pagan Koff play? He did play more tonight than he did last night. He played 16 minutes tonight, which is good, but still feel like Juddy's kind of being cautious with his minutes, like he's on a little bit of a limited basis. We'll see if that's lifted next week, because he looked pretty fluid tonight,
He did. We'll see how he feels tonight.
Right.
I thought I saw one time when he was sprinting back to get on defense, and he kind of stopped and he kind of hobbled a little bit after that. And, you know, he's playing through pain probably anyway, but hopefully he's able to. They need him. You can see the difference with Jack Pagan Koff out on the court. They need him. They need Cameron Chatwin back. I mean he's another big that gives you another option inside. He was just starting to come into his own too. And another, like, you know, like Matt Conway, can stretch it and shoot it a little bit. And you know, I bumped into him on campus, you know, the other day, and he said, "I probably won't be able to play this week, and we're really trying to shoot for next weekend." And so we'll see. You know, you just never know with some of those, you know, some of those injuries, and hope they can get him back and really try to make a run, you know, at this thing. Like Devin said, you know, at this point, especially 6 losses in RMAC play, regular season title is out of the question. But you can play your way. I mean, and you may even be out of the question of hosting an RMAC tournament game. Now, I think now you're maybe, you know, you're maybe gunning for that 5, 6, 7, 8 spot, trying to get in. And still, this Dixie State team is not a team that I would want to play.
No.
In the RMAC tournament. It's going to be all about, you know, trying to get to that tournament, making a run, and maybe you can, you know, be that team that, you know, in those years Dixie State's been on the bubble, the 8th spot in the region, and they've been bumped out because of an upset in the RMAC tournament. Maybe it's Dixie State's turn this year to return that favor. But they've got to tweak a few things and play their way into that RMAC tournament first.
And it's a whole new look team. You lost so much talent last year, and guys like Brandon Simister and Trevor Hill, and the list goes on and on. And I still feel like the guys are searching to find that chemistry. It just hasn't clicked. And I thought that, you know, once we got to the new year, as the season progressed, we'd start to see this team get better and better and better. And that can still happen, but it's been a slower progression than I'm sure Coach Judkins would like.
Absolutely. And you saw that tonight. You know, Coach Judkins pushed a lot of buttons. He tried a lot of different combinations to find that right chemistry, that right lineup. And he found it there for a little bit. He got a good group in there that made a good run to get him back into the game, but just not enough tonight.
When he's probably in there banging his head against the wall, just thinking, what do we have to do? They had a slow start yesterday, but a great second half last night. and you thought maybe, you know, maybe that'll carry over into tonight's game. But, you know, it kind of goes back to that New Mexico Highlands game and then into Pueblo.
Yep.
The next night, what is it the back-to-backs? What is the difference on this Saturday end of these Friday-Saturday doubleheaders, you know, even at home, to not be able to get those sweeps? I mean, that's been Coach Judkins' mantra from day one. If you can split on the road, win your games at home, you give yourself a really good chance to be in a good spot, you know, toward the end of that conference season. And, you know, and one thing, too, we're just not used to this. We've been so spoiled with so many teams that just reloaded and reloaded and reloaded over 8, 9, 10 years. And finally you have a team where 6 seniors graduate at one time, and they're trying to do – and they've still done some good things this year and plenty of good things to come. So,
well, you know, you go back to the recruiting in the offseason. There was a couple guys that Coach Judkins really wanted that he just missed out on. It came down to Dixie State and another school, and they went elsewhere. And he still loves the guys he has, but you feel like they're just, you know, maybe one more, you know, pure scorer away. You don't have a Trevor Hill that can really create and elevate and get his shot whenever he wants and play above the rim. You're kind of missing that. Conway's really playing out of position when he's playing the five. You know, without Austin Montgomery, you're playing Conway at the five a lot. You're playing Dub at the four. And so you got a makeshift lineup. And that's why I think, to Mike's point, you saw a really balanced minutes tonight. I mean, Conway 26, Dub played 32, the most on the team. Quincy 18, Frampton 28, Wilson 20, 16 from Pagankoff. Dayson played, you know, 18. Bubba played 20. Julian played 22. And that's what you got to do on a back-to-back. You do have to try to balance the minutes, and it was pretty balanced tonight. Just didn't get the win.
No, and they've got to figure out a way to start games. You know, Carrick, you touched on it a little bit. We've talked about it all night.
Uphill all night.
Yeah, you can't dig yourself that big of a hole. And, you know, maybe you're at home and you feel like, yeah, we can put together a pretty good comeback. We've done it before, but those holes are tough to get out of, and especially against an Eagles team like we saw tonight. They're explosive. They're all over the place. That's a tough defense, a very well-coached team. But, you know, Dixie, if they can figure out a way to start those games and not have to fight from behind, I think they'll be okay.
Eventually, you know, you dig enough holes, you start getting buried
in
those holes. And tonight, I think, was one of those nights. You know, it's interesting to think, too. I think a couple years, you look at the roster this year, if you go a couple years back, coaching staff was ahead of the eight ball on this thing. They, you know, they brought Austin Montgomery in. They brought Brandon Miller in. They brought guys like that. You know, this is supposed to be a junior or senior season. You know, just imagine the difference if Montgomery's out there. If Brandon Miller still never would have got hurt and is out there. You know, guys like that just because of injuries, if, you know, their careers have basically, and who knows what will happen with Austin Montgomery the rest of the way this year. But we just have to wait and see what happens. Excuse me, Dixie State falling in this one 64-61, and a tough one. You know, it's hard on these nights as we're inside the Camping World post-game show. It's hard to maybe name a player of the game and a play of the game. But tonight, I think if you're leaning toward that player of the game, I think you've got to go with, you know, it would have been, in the first half, it would have been Julian Decree. I think in the second half and for the overall game, you got to go with Andre Wilson.
Absolutely.
I mean, what a game Andre played tonight.
He did. Both ends of the floor. You know, he had a chance. He's going to have a rough time sleeping tonight
with that free throw.
Third free throw.
But he's got to remember that there was 12 other free throws that were missed before that could have made that difference.
I think he's a definite candidate for player of the game.
Yeah, I like the way he played. I don't know what his career high or season high was in front of me, but, you know, 16, that's good. That's good stuff. I mean, and they needed every one of them just to have a chance. I thought he shot the three really well, 5 of 7 from the line. That was, you know, better than a lot of guys on the team. Two guys were perfect from the line. Everybody else at least missed one tonight. So, you know, you go back to the drawing board. You know, I think Judd's probably spending a lot more time in film room this year than he has the last couple years where he's had guys in the system. And you got to spend an hour or two on Mondays, maybe even longer, showing them the little things that put them in that uphill climb. That early deficit. Now, not much Juddy can do about a 1-for-8 start from the field, but there's some other things. Defensively, though, I mean, it's a work in progress. Rebounding is just effort. That's all rebounding is. It's just effort. And you said at the pregame show, Mike, and this kind of resonates with me, energy. They waited too long to bring the energy. I thought they brought it late, but then Chadron just kept getting offensive rebound after offensive rebound and key jump shots and floaters. And it was just a little bit too much to overcome tonight. That three at the buzzer by Wilson, just well defended. And Chadron better defensively than we've seen coming into the Burns Arena in a while. And the RMAC play, we're still learning these teams. But that was a really good defensive effort tonight from Chadron State.
Well, we knew what we were getting when Chadron State was coming in, a very gritty, athletic team that did a lot of things well. I think it was his team that, you know, they lost in overtime. They had, speaking of free throws, I was talking to their radio guy before this game started. At some point, I don't know if it was in regulation. I think it was in regulation. A technical foul was called against Westminster. Chadron State actually had a free throw to win it and missed it.
That five then, straight,
yeah,
right?
And then lost in overtime. And, and that's a team that they might have been tired, but they're motivated to win. And they came down here. And you just, you know, with the back-to-backs, I think it's the great equalizer. It is what it is. I mean, you deal with it on the road. Your opponents deal with it here. And it's the great equalizer, and anybody can beat anybody on any given night in this Rocky Mountain Athletic Conference.
Well, and you're kind of learning at this point in time that you try to at least split on the road, and then you want to win 2-0 at home. I mean, that's the ultimate goal, I think, in this conference, to make sure you're in that top four. If you can do that all season long, you're probably going to be up there and hosting a conference playoff game. And now Dixie State's put themselves in a position where – you know, they need a 5 or 6-game win streak regardless of where their game's played. But now you look at the schedule ahead, and you got those four straight on the road, and that's going to be a little bit more difficult. But you look at this Chadron State. They went to Mesa, they went to Westminster, and then they came to Dixie State. And they go 2 out of 3. I mean, they got to feel pretty good on that trip home.
Oh, absolutely. And that's the thing. You've got a ton of basketball to be played here. So, you know, you can't go into that locker room and hang your head too low, you know, just low enough to really motivate, to hate that feeling, to want to make whatever changes need to be made to change the starts. I mean, you can't fall in a 9-0, 9-2 hole. We've talked about it already. We're beating a dead horse now, but you can't afford to do that. Of everything else that happened tonight, you gotta give yourself a chance to be neck and neck all throughout the game. And I was in total agreement with what you said, Mike, during the broadcast, that if Dixie State was able to get over the hump and taste that, you know, the taste of the lead, I think they would have gone on a run, and this would have been a different chance. They just could not get over the hump tonight.
Closest
and,
they got was the start of the game.
They got within one a couple different times. I tell you, for me, and Dixie State had gotten within one at one point and had momentum.
That's right.
And then there was a 3-point shot. I'm not going to say who took it. I don't need to do that. A 3-point shot from the right wing right here with about 22, 23, 24 seconds left on the shot clock. It went the other way for a quick bucket. And then there was two more possessions just like that after that. For me, that's kind of when the game, Dixie State had made that run, chipped away, and then kind of where maybe it got out of, not totally out of reach, but out of control again.
In that last 35 seconds, you really miss a Brandon Simister-type player because, you know, you try to roll a screen and a hook off Bubba to get him a look. It's not there, so he shovels over to Dub, and with 5 seconds left, Dub takes kind of a fadeaway, you know, 24-footer from the right angle, but you kind of had to if you're Dub Price. That's not a bad shot.
At that point,
but
the
that's not a
high
percentage three-point shot. You know, you need – an open look, which is difficult to do in crunch time in that situation. I hate to, you know, point out the timeout situation, but, you know, if you're able to get those two misses and take that timeout, then you get a better three at the buzzer than Wilson's running floater contested. And so a couple chances to win it, even though they never had the lead in this game, just didn't go the Trailblazers way.
Coach Judkins, I'm sure, has a lot to talk about with his guys tonight. I mean, named a player of the game, Jimmy John's play of the game. Is there anything that we can think of? Julian Decree had a nice move and kind of reversed it from left to right a time or two. There was some big, you know, Andre had some big shots in the second half. Anything coming to mind, you know, that we could dub as a play of the game tonight?
I think there's a few candidates for sure. I thought that the play that they ran at the end, it was out of a timeout, very well executed play. It looked like the type of play that it was brand new.
Yeah,
and they needed a bucket, and it, great shot, and they got a good look. Andre got fouled on the three, and eventually missed the third of the three foul shots. But I thought that was a solid play. I think if you look at it, that was the play that was going to tie it. They executed it great. They just couldn't capitalize on it. I think there's a few others. There was the Jack Pagankoff shot that cut it to a three-possession game.
Devin, what are you thinking?
Yeah, I mean, I like some of the post moves from Juju, but they didn't really – I mean, they kept Dixie State in it, but you got to look at something late there. And when you lose a game, it's really
tough.
Yeah,
it's really, really hard.
A play of the game. I did like the set that Mike was talking about. They got the extra pass to Wilson for that chance to tie the game. I mean, and when you're losing, you're looking at something that ultimately set up a chance to win. So you probably by default go to that play. I would agree.
Dixie State falling 64-61. Still no sign of the coach. I don't know. Take a break. Come back and see if he's made his way here. Let's step away. 60-second timeout. And we'll come back, continue to break it down, and hope to be able to sit down with the coach. 60-second timeout, right back on the Trailblazer Basketball Network.
There is a place where rocks bleed, and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy. Where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents, and opponents are friends. Where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
Okay, we are inviting you to join us for Talking Point Live.
Coming to you, not necessarily live, but tape delayed on the Community Education Channel at 9:30, 12:30, and 4:30 daily, from what I understand. But you can also pick it up on our Facebook page at facebook.com/talkingpointlive.
And respond to us, right?
Please, let us know, because it's important to understand not only how our conversation is going, but maybe how is it affecting you at home as well, all right? Eric Young.
Jennifer Kohler.
Talking Point Live, we'll see you.
Welcome back inside the Burns Arena one final time. We are joined by head coach John Judkins in the post-game show. We'll get his comments on this one, and then we'll all get on with the weekend and then looking forward to next weekend's games in Colorado. Coach, thanks for joining us here, taking time after a tough loss. I know it's not easy to talk about some of these, and some nights it feels like it's just kind of the same things, you know, repeated over and over and over. Just a tough one tonight overall, digging yourself a hole at first, and then finally catches up with you, not able to dig out of it.
Yeah, that's the part that's so frustrating. You know, it's just two times in a row now that we've been at home and a team plays Westminster the night before, loses in overtime. They travel 4 hours and they have more energy than we do. I just don't. There's no excuse for that. You're gonna make mistakes. You know, basketball is a team that makes the least mistakes normally wins. Jerry Sloan is famous for that, of saying the team that makes the least mistakes and also who scores the easiest baskets wins. You know, I thought we played hard, but I mean that last 4 minutes we played hard, but we played dumb. You know, I thought we shot a couple of really bad shots. We got within one. I thought, okay, here we go. We get this lead, and we shoot a terrible shot. You know, and then they go down and hit a three. Now we're down four. They got to be smarter with that. But if I asked you guys right now, they probably already talked about it, tell me two things what you think we lost the game. That's what I asked my team. And
too many rebounds given up, okay, on the glass, and then too many points in the paint.
Left 13 points at the line.
Yeah, that's. I wrote down two things. We got out rebounded by 19. They got 16 offensive rebounds. They got four of those at the foul line, which we have four guys against their two, and they get it. And then foul shots. You know, we get to the line, we shoot 58%. And, I mean, there's no pressure. The only time there's pressure on a kid, Andre had pressure. Going up there, down three, have three shots. That's some serious pressure. He made two out of the three. That was pretty good. But we go up there one-on-ones, we miss. We go up there for two and miss. You know, Julian goes 2 for 7. Matt goes 3 for 7. You know, you just – that those are killers, you know. And then, like you said, point in the paint. But you take those two things out, I think rebounds, I always give them 1 point for every offensive rebound they get. And a lot of times it could be even more than that if they hit threes. But if you really look at it, think, you know, there's a chance. 16 offensive boards – that's probably 16 rebounds that they – or 16 points that they probably scored off it. And so, to me, that's the game. You know, we get a stop. I thought the turning point, too, is Jack misses both three throws. I think we're down, I can't remember what it was, three. We're down three with, okay, we'll be down one here, get a stop. And he misses two foul shots, and they go down. They run the shot clock down. They shoot a bad shot with 22 seconds on the shot clock, and Jack doesn't decide to block off, and the guy gets it and scores. I mean, that's a five-point swing right there where, you know what, I mean, if I missed a foul shot, I guarantee you I'm going to go down and defend and rebound, and I don't know. And he had a great game yesterday, but, you know, like I told you guys earlier, when you don't play for a while, you either play really good or you play really bad. Yeah. And tonight I thought he didn't – they kind of bit him in the butt. Maybe the, you know, being off. I think you're so excited that first game, you kind of get those things going, and then tonight it caught up to him. But we just – I don't know. It's – we're just doing this roller coaster stuff. That's what we're talking about. Are we going to keep doing this all year long, or are we going to fight back and figure it out? I thought the way we started the game the last three games have been terrible. You know, we got to change. I have changed my lineup a couple times with, you know, with Bubba and Quincy. I've changed it today with Andre instead of Dayson. All right, I started Dace in the second half instead of the first half. I mean, I got to try something to make it work. And maybe it's got to be Dub and Matt. I don't know. I got to try something. It's just not working. You know, we're just not – it's like we – tonight I felt like we were hoping to win instead of just, hey, let's go win this. You know, every timeout, every media timeout, I kept bringing that up. Okay, we got to win this 4 minutes. We got to win this 4 minutes. And we didn't win one of them. We never got – well, we won some of them, but we never got ahead. And I thought once we got ahead, I thought, okay, we'll get this. And it just – give them a lot of credit. They played extremely hard for being on the road. They really wanted this game bad. And you saw them afterwards, and they beat us. They're celebrating and jumping up and down. I mean, it was a big game for us, and give them a lot of credit. But we just did some not, you know, even like the end of the game, you know, I told him I want to work on stuff at the end of the game. We normally do that. We've done a little bit of it. I want to do more of it, but I can't do the end game stuff if we can't figure out how to play the 38, 37 minutes before that. I got to figure that out first. And I don't know, just really, really frustrating. And, you know, we can blame injuries and we can blame this and these guys aren't playing. It's true. It's hard. Some of our best players aren't playing, you know, that we recruited. But do we just cancel the game, or does somebody else got to step up? And right now those guys aren't stepping up, and we got to get that fixed.
Coach, how frustrating was it? Happened, really forced your hand to use timeouts to kind of get back into the game, but then you didn't have one with the last 35 seconds.
It hurt. I was trying again, yelling, 33's like a 25% foul shooter, so we got down like four or five, and I was trying to get Dub's attention to foul him. But I didn't have a timeout, like I said, to call it and hurry and do it. And we had a few times where he caught the ball and we did foul him and he kicked it back out, where I thought that would have been a big one too. But you're right, those timeouts, you don't get a lot. I mean, there's a lot of timeouts with the medias, but you don't get them when you really need them. And so I hate to burn the ones I have because we're not playing hard or we're not ready to play. And, you know, I try the first half, I try everything to save them. I use one timeout sometimes because you have the one.
Welcome back inside the post-game report. Coach Judkins not with us anymore, but that power was inadvertently cut off to the table, and we lost him. And I'm not so sure that Coach Judkins didn't arrange that in advance. Did not have to talk about this. No, he was good about it and chatting with us about it. And just, you know, you tell this, you know, as we knew that he would be just frustrated about the, you know, about the night and about what's going on. And really digging deep to try to figure this thing out, and hopefully they'll be able to. So, Devin, final thoughts. Mike, final thoughts on this one, and before we turn the page on it, because after a while, harping on it isn't really going to help anything. You got to turn the page on it, try to move forward.
Yeah, and it's going to be a tough road ahead. You know, you got those road games you alluded to, but, you know, some bright spots. Try to spin some positives. You know, Andre Wilson had one of his better games this season. Proved he can knock down the three. I mean, was 3 for 4 from distance. I thought that was nice. Julian Decree, I thought, in the first half, really started to play some defense. We know he can score the basketball. He had 9 first-half points, ended the night with 12. But in the second half, I think he needs to continue to feed the offense off of good defensive plays. Get that block. Take that charge. You know, if that happens, I think then the other guys like Conway didn't get a lot of shots tonight, just 2 of 7 from the floor. I thought Quincy played a little bit better tonight. That was nice to see. I think, you know, give him a little confidence, put him in the starting lineup. I thought he's doing nice things. I thought he got a couple tough calls that went against him on some charges where he could have had a couple more points than his 6 points tonight. You know, Bubba didn't get a lot of looks tonight. You know, it's a concerted team effort. You know, when one guy plays good, you got to have two or three guys. You really have a big three anymore. You know, you can't have just one guy have 16, another guy 12. You need more than that. And that's you win as a team, you lose as a team. And tonight just happened to be on the wrong side of a loss. But, you know, Juddy won't give up on these guys. And hopefully these guys don't give up on Juddy and they can find a little winning streak out on the road. Go get 3 out of 4.
Yeah.
You got a nice February stretch coming up with a lot of home games. Fans continue to come out and support the team. Good crowd this weekend. Last night especially was a great crowd with the big announcement and a lot of people in town and on campus. And the future is bright at Dixie State, even though this one's a tough one to swallow.
That's right. You know, look, this is another close game that they've lost. Right? A lot of these games, they've lost a lot of close games there towards the end. They'll learn from it. The one thing about this team that I've noticed is their ability to bounce back, their ability to, you know, even though they're down, make a run and get going and recover. So, and that's exactly what they have to do tonight. You know, they've got to put this one behind them. They've got to go home, let it hurt a little bit tonight. It should hurt. And okay, go home and let that hurt sink in a little bit. But then they've got to be ready to go Monday and move forward.
Dixie State falling 64-61. It's a tough one, but it's out on the road heading to Colorado Christian and to Regis in the Denver area. And then those two schools pretty close together in the Denver area, same hotel the whole time. The next weekend will be the really tough one. You go to Colorado Mesa, Grand Junction, and then you got a bus to Gunnison, Colorado, to Western Colorado University. And that, you know, it's, you know, 3 hours in good weather, three and a half hours in good weather, and who knows what it'll be like that night. So who knows? Maybe he'll get one of these second end of the back and back wins like some of these guys have been getting here in the Burns. So
I like what I'm seeing though. Juju out on the court shooting free throws. That's good. That's good. Yeah. Wade Miller was out shooting some free throws. One of the two things that Juddy circled and you know, addressed, the rebounding, the free throw shooting. So hopefully the guys continue to work on that. And as a coach, not much you can do about a, you know, 36% shooting night. It's not much you can do. In the first half, 42% in the second half. I don't know. But this team was, they showed heart again. I like that. I like the fact that they showed heart. But, you know, like Juddy and you pinpointed this in the pregame, Carrick, you got to come out with the energy like Mike was talking about. And you just can't fall behind. You just have to exert too much. And it wasn't meant to be. But we look forward to the next radio broadcast coming up that first weekend of February, February
Absolutely.
3rd. We'll be back here on ESPN Radio when they come back home.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, everyone, for listening tonight and being part of it. If you're listening or watching on TV, always got to thank our CEC TV crew for their hard work and everything.
Great job, yeah.
Everything they do. It's long days. It's been a long weekend, really, and they've been doing stuff every week with high school and some of the stuff they've been doing, you know, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, all day Friday with the announcement and this. And so appreciate, you know, Marcus, James, Lauren, Trey, Dave, all the guys and gals over at CEC TV. Appreciate Kylie Young for joining us sideline reports tonight. And she did color with me during the women's game. Well, that was fun. Appreciate Ken, our radio producer back in the 97.7 FM studio, getting us on the air and keeping us on the air throughout the night. For Devin Dixon and Mike Olson, I'm Carrick Segmuller. Thank you for listening. We'll be back on the air in a couple of weeks after the road game. Have a good night, everybody.